would like to call the April 3rd, 2017 school committee meeting to order. It's April, it's opening day. Red Sox are playing, so spring is.
And they won,
that's right.
Yeah.
So finally, spring is here. I do not believe anybody signed up for public comment, but I will ask, is there anyone here from the public who wants to address something not on the agenda? Seeing none. Our first order of business is a donation. We generally accept donations in our consent agenda, but every now and then we are lucky to have the group that raised the funds come in and present, and we're lucky tonight to be joined by members of the board of the Reading Education Foundation. So if you would mind approaching the mic, I understand you have an extremely generous donation to make to the Reading Public Schools this evening.
So on behalf of the Reading Education Foundation's Board of Directors, I'm happy to announce that we will be funding $45,000 in teacher grants this year, along with piloting a new professional development fund. This new fund will be available during the 2017-2018 school year to teachers within the district, and we will be making a formal announcement later on in the school year regarding that. And I'm going to turn things over to our grant chair, Nancy Dieselman, who will let you know about the 9 grants we're funding.
Thank you. Hi, thank you. So yes, this year, as Mike said, we're starting a professional development fund that is going to be open to teachers year and the district year round. And in addition to that, we have our regular teacher grants. And this year we're funding 9 grants. Two are for the community, one at the high school level, and 3 at the middle school level, and 3 at the elementary school level. We have 2 community grants now. Both of them are public speakers that are coming in. The first one is Dr. Christopher Willard, a mindfulness speaker that's coming in that just got rescheduled for May 15th this year because of a snow day. And next fall, we will be having a speaker. And that one is in conjunction with the Joshua Eaton WASH Committee and the other Reading PTOs, and we all got together to fund it. We're also having a social media safety expert coming in next fall. And the reason for this is that this is a very dynamic public speaker who has really engaged both parents and students in other districts. And this is the kind of topic that you really need to have that type of speaker so that maybe it hits home a little bit. And so the teacher that proposed this has seen this person and has had really great feedback from parents and students in other districts. So we're looking forward to that. Our high school grant this year, we are doing in conjunction with the Reading High School PTO, and we are funding laptops for health and wellness program. And right now they don't have anything that's dedicated, and there's so much curriculum material out there that really expands what the teachers can do if they have this technology at their hands for their students. And what the real goal there is to just engage the students. It's the kind of topic where sometimes they lose the kids and it's not that interesting, but if you make it, you know, if you present them with material that's engaging, that we hope that they'll have more success. Middle school, we have 3 different grants, and I'll just highlight one of them. The Coolidge School is very excited to redesign their foyer, to have a student-centered foyer. And they basically want to celebrate the students and have it be something that supports social and emotional well-being. And so they're going to be doing a mural where all the students participate in doing it. And Ref's part, we're helping to provide an LCD screen, a sound system, and software that controls it. And the students are going to actively on a daily basis be working with the front office to change the programming of what goes on. And it's going to include everything from, you know, just everyday scheduling things of what's going on and students' achievements all the way to live feeds of different events that are going on in the school. And lastly, there are 3 elementary grants for the elementary schools, and I'll just highlight one of them. 2 schools, Birch Meadow and Wood End, we had special education teachers from both those schools that asked for specialized seating material that will help highly active students achieve better attention. And we granted something similar to this a couple of years ago, and it was very successful. And it's basically an expansion on that. And it not only helps those students, but you can imagine how much it changes the dynamics of that classroom. If you settle down the kids who are, you know, just so hyper, and now the entire classroom benefits from it. So it's the kind of materials such as standing desks, and they now have wobble chairs in addition to ball chairs. So we're, the special education teachers are going to disperse them throughout the school so that each classroom has at least a couple of pieces, and they'll identify what classrooms if they need more or less. So just a quick summary of the grants that we have this year.
Wow. Unbelievable.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Don't know if anyone on the committee has any questions.
I have a question. When is your imagination celebration?
Oh, I was going to, yeah. So I'm Lori Foley. I'm the treasurer of REF, and I just wanted to plug a few of our events. We have our spring event coming up soon. It's our Imagination Celebration. It'll be Saturday, April 29th at the Four Point Sheraton over in Wakefield, which is where we had it last year. I hope everybody can join us. We'd love to have you. We also, in conjunction with the IC, we run an online auction, which I know a lot of you are familiar with, through Bidding for Good. And that's open April 24th through May 8th. So if you want to support us through our online auction or come to our event, we would be thrilled to have you. We're still in the planning phases of it, but I wanted to plug, we are just about at $10,000 for sponsorship. So that just goes to show you how great our local businesses and community is in supporting what we do at Reading Education Foundation. We're also running a Pamplemousse is running a wine tasting where they're going to be donating their proceeds to the Reading Education Foundation, which I believe is April 8th. So if you are available to do that, I know that's a great event anyway, and they have donated to us in the past as a way to give back to the community, which is excellent. We're also running a paint night sometime in May, but I don't have the date offhand, at the Tin Bucket, which is also a local place here in town that loves to support Reading Education Foundation. So that's another fun night. And then in May and June, we do the teacher tributes, where people can nominate a teacher and give a donation to REF, and then that teacher gets a recognition of from that family on, you know, their accomplishments or just their favorite teacher. And we have actually partnered with the PTOs with that the last couple of years, and it's been very successful, where they get a portion of the money that goes right back to the schools. And of course, we're going to target that money also to this new professional development fund so that teachers are able to bring all the stuff that they learn back to the classrooms. So it's a lot of exciting things, but for us to give you guys $45,000, we have to do a lot of work throughout the year. So,
thank you. You really do.
But I really, you know, the town is great. I mean, obviously, we also run our Festival of Trees, which is the first weekend in December. But we feel like we have a great community that supports the schools and really puts their support in funds. So we appreciate it and happy to give it back to you guys.
Thank you so much.
Any
other questions from the committee?
I just want to say I think the teacher tribute is a great program, and I know like seniors, students probably don't think of it so much, but it is sort of, at least at the high school, it's a great way, or when kids are moving up, to, you know, reflect on the teachers that have had a big impact on them. I have found that my sons were, you know, What are you doing? So I just said, you know what? Fine. I appreciate the teachers, and I can recognize them. So I know it's hard to get the kids to sometimes to do that kind of thing, but I think it's a great opportunity, especially at those big transition times, and to sort of reflect on who helped you along the way.
Well, we, of course, appreciate the funds, but I think the teachers appreciate the sentiments. It means a lot to them. They get the acknowledgement, and, you know, I mean, when you work hard all year, it's nice to have families recognize that. So it's a win-win, really.
Well, I'm struck by, as you were going through what the grants are funding, how very cutting edge issues of mindfulness, of the mind-body connection with the physical spaces for elementary students and social media safety. I mean, the fundraising you're doing and giving it to us is allowing us to stay cutting edge in a lot of really important areas. And the professional development, the last couple of years, we've cut that budget a lot, and you're filling in some of that gap. So you're really providing a vital service for our students.
Thank you. You said part of what I was going to say, but your slogan, thinking outside of the box, is really what we've seen you do, and we all benefit. I think that you empower our teachers to keep their passion
for thinking outside of the box in places where we might be tightening our belts. You enable us to empower them, and that's just priceless. And I would just want to thank you all.
We all very much.
You're welcome. But it's really a community effort. I mean, we get a lot of support from a lot of people. So, you know, when people are out there saying that people don't support the schools, they really do. And it is nice. Yeah.
People and businesses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, and I think we've really gotten some momentum with what we're funding, and people are appreciative of that, so.
And your events are so fun, too.
Oh, they are. They're that.
They really are.
Yeah, well, thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you. We'll do another.
Yeah.
Want to make a motion?
Yep. Move to accept the annual donation from the Reading Education Foundation in the amount of $45,035.48 to be used to fund the 2016-17 educational grant.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any other comments?
I'll be sending the rail check in. I don't think you can take this.
Thank you right. so
thank
much.
You.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
All those in favor? It passes 6-0. We have a consent agenda tonight. I want to make the community aware that we did remove, included in the consent agenda was a fifth grade field trip to nature's classroom. We have removed that from the consent agenda at the request of a couple of committee members. So our current consent agenda includes a lot of very extremely generous donations to fund many different levels and areas of education in Reading, as well as a couple of other field trips, and some minutes are in there.
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Yes.
I actually, I'm a little, I'd like to pull the 227 minutes.
Yep.
I had a question about that, and I have an apology with this. I tried to open it, and I couldn't. And I know that when I voiced my questions, there was a lot of work done to answer my questions, but I couldn't read the answers because I couldn't open it from where I was.
Yep. So Linda reached out and had some additions she wanted to make to the minutes, and Linda Engelson, as usual, went and did all of it, but technology. So I think we pull that and postpone it to another meeting.
I apologize that we need to do that.
Move to approve the consent agenda as amended.
Second. Any discussion on the consent? Oh, you're not allowed to discuss. Did
no.
you want to remove something?
I just was trying to add up. This is an amazing amount of donations, and I'm up to like 24,000 plus the 45, and I'm actually not done adding it up. And I just want to highlight how incredibly generous the community is. And in particular, there's $16,000 worth of anonymous donations for social emotional learning. And
Birch Meadow Library,
right. Like, I am just, you're all out there, the community. I just want to say thank you. I think people understand we are in a really, really tough financial position, and really appreciate people's generosity. And people are in difficult financial positions as well. So we really, really, truly appreciate that. And it's like $65,000 at least right now.
Lori said it well. This is a community that does support schools.
Just one question for the superintendent. Do we have not suggesting we create new work, I'm just curious, do we have a tracking of all these different community donations that we've had?
We keep track. Last year we reported out it was $160,000.
I want to highlight that.
Actually, it was one of the questions in the budget presentation. So we listed the past, I want to say, 2 or 3 years.
Mm-hmm. And do we have it by kind of type of donation? Because there's also a lot of variety here. I mean, there's a lot of supporting athletics. There were library books that were given. There were professional development. There's a band trip. There's Science Olympiad. So if people wanted that information, is that just in the packet? Just, I'm not suggesting we do
it
more work.
It is in the packet, and we tried to list it out amount and who from it. If it was designated for a specific purpose, we listed what that was. So we did give some.
And the packet was where the budget.
It's in the question and answer document.
For the FY18 budget?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so if people are interested, that's a good resource to look at, because it really is significant, the diversity of support as well as the depth.
Yeah. All right, are we ready for a vote? All those in favor? 6-0. Dr. Doherty.
Yes.
You were going to give us a little bit more information about the grade 5 field trip to Nature's Classroom.
You have in your packet the full application to Nature's Classroom. This is something that the elementary principals have been working on for the last couple of months. I've been part of a lot of those meetings, so I know the thought process that was going, that they were going through. Essentially, they've outgrown the Camp Bourndale space for both a, when they were going as a couple of schools or three schools at a time, to some of the program offerings that were part of the program. They looked into several different types of programs, and they decided to go with Nature's Classroom. Nature's Classroom, for those of you who may not know, is something that we have been a partner with Nature's Classroom for over 20 years in the Reading Public Schools. Both Coolidge and Parker go to Nature's Classroom every year as part of their seventh grade experience. Nature's Classroom offers similar programming as Camp Bourndale did, all the way down to fourth grade. So they are used to working with younger students. And so this, one of the reasons why they chose this particular Nature's Classroom site, and there are several all over New England, is because it was able to accommodate all of the fifth graders at the same time. They felt that a lot was being lost when they were going as two separate trips. And they heard that in the feedback from parents. They heard that in the feedback from kids. And in terms of the program strength and the quality of the counselors, all of those things will be very similar to Bourndale. The number of chaperones, the ratio of chaperones is going to be very similar. There are a lot of parents that go on this, as well as teachers and administrators. All five elementary principals are the lead administrators for this trip. They go on the trip as part of the experience, as well as fifth grade teachers, other teachers, and parents. This is actually less expensive than Bourndale. That isn't the primary driver of why they were doing it, but it is less expensive than Bourndale. I believe it's half the price when you factor it all in. If Bourndale was over $200. This is around 100, right? I believe it's 100.
Bourndale is typically funded partly out of the PTO and partly from parents.
That will continue to be the same. Okay. Yes.
But it should be less to both
yes.
groups.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And you have a whole overview in your packet about Nature's Classroom. They have a very, very strong program. The program that they offer is similar no matter what site you go. Coolidge goes to Prindle Pond, and I believe Parker goes to Beckett, but the program is the same. And you'll see the same thing with the elementary piece. The only piece, it's only one day, so you're not, everything that they list is not what's going to be done. You need a whole 5 days to be able to do all of the programs that are offered there. But I know that the teachers and the administrators will choose the appropriate program for the curriculum that connects to what they're learning in fifth grade.
Dr. Boxer.
Just a couple of questions. When the students go, will the fifth graders be all mixed together, or will they stay according to their schools?
I don't know that. That's probably information that would be explained at the parent nights. Yeah. So if you approve this, the next step is that there will be parent information where Nature's Classroom will come, and they will present to the parents of at the different schools.
I was just thinking that it's a really nice way to bridge that journey into middle school so that they'll know more of the kids that they're going to be with the following year. So I was thinking mm-hmm. about that. Thank you. Yeah. Oh, and just that I had the good fortune to be a chaperone at Nature's Classroom and enjoyed it very much and saw the benefits for the kids. That was in middle school, though.
Mr. Robinson.
Move to approve the fifth grade field trip to Nature's Classroom in Freedom, New Hampshire on October 16th and 17th, 2017.
Is there a second?
A second.
Any other questions or discussions?
Just have a quick question while the motion's pending for the superintendent. The seventh grade programming, is that overnight programming?
It's a 5 day, it's a 5 or 3 day program. Yeah.
So we have experience with this site. with our older students already?
Not at this site. Coolidge goes to Prindle Pond, Parker goes to Beckett.
It's all Nature's
but
Classroom.
The program itself is all Nature's Classroom. It's the same company.
Okay. And the ratio, we're committing to the 36 chaperones along with the 17 teachers. That's a...
Yes. There's actually more than that because during the day, the Nature's Classroom staff basically take over the program.
Okay. So it's even better than the 1 to 12 in
yes.
the Dear Parents letter. It's actually half that. So
yes.
It's actually about 1 to 6. So, all right.
I have a question. You're not concerned about duplicity, having the same experience in 5th and 7th grade?
No, it's a great question. And we talked a lot about that with the elementary principals. The fact that this is only one night, there's only so much you can do in one night. It shouldn't be. In fact, it may increase, interest down the road.
I was just thinking the flip side of that coin is it's a taste of what you're going to get in seventh grade.
Correct.
So that could be kind of nice. Yeah, Ms. Robinson.
So, and we make available help if people need it.
Yes, there is financial help if needed.
Are there other examples of grade-wide? Because the change that we're making is going from 2 schools to 5. Do we have experience with grade-wide field trips? I think in the middle school level, we do across.
We do Washington, D.C. some years. 8th grade has gone on trips like that. Right now, we have a group of students. It's not the entire 8th grade, but going to Quebec.
Okay.
And that's a Parker Coolidge experience right now. So there are others. Some we do have day trips. Like I believe grade 5 has gone to the BSO as a group. So I there have been other opportunities.
So one more question.
Yep.
In the past with Thorndale, there's been significant surveying of parents and kids and staff afterwards to make sure that it's beneficial for all. From all perspectives. I assume the staff is going to be doing a similar process after this to make sure that this change is
yes.
viewed positively. Okay. Yeah, I'll be interested to hear how that goes.
Yep. And then just to confirm something I think I heard earlier, it was all of the principals collaborating, all 5 elementary principals.
That's correct.
Putting the program together and selecting this site.
That is correct.
Okay.
Anything else from the committee? Are we ready for a vote? All those in favor? 6-0. Reports. You want to kick us off, Alex?
There's a bunch of stuff going on. First, on Saturday, the symphonic band, the concert band at high school, went to Mica, and we got a silver medal.
Yeah.
Which was very exciting. Also, there was a formal recital this past weekend at high school, and there was a playwriting showcase on Saturday. So, students have been it's like an after-school activity, so they've been coming at night from school, and they wrote 10-minute plays, which I support. And also, Arts Fest is coming up this week, so the high school bands and choruses are coming.
Thank you.
And the spring sports have recently started up, so I don't participate in one, but I know that a lot of the lacrosse guys are playing hockey, so I hope they do well and hope track stays consistent. So.
Exciting to be in spring. Alex, I'm going to share an update on behalf of our senior. Alex will be leaving the Reading Public Schools in a couple months when she graduates, but I found out this evening, she's known for a while, but I only just found out that she's made a decision about where she'll be in September. So I want to congratulate you on attending the College of the Holy Cross in Worcester. Excellent choice as an alum. But we're really going to miss you. You're an exceptional student rep. You're so positive about your time at the high school. And there have been a couple of instances where you've had a very strong opinion and you've represented the student population about particularly budget cuts that were going to impact the high school. And you weren't afraid to come to this committee and speak for the students. So you should be really proud of that. We're going to miss you. So congratulations.
Yeah.
All right. Does anybody have a liaison report? Yep. Dr. Doxer.
So the Human Relations Advisory Committee has our meeting. Our monthly meeting is this Thursday at 7 at the police station. Please come. We'd love your input. We just had a meeting of the CPAC. I will leave a lot of this to Ms. Wilson to report on. But I wanted to say that the Coffee and Conversation program has been drawing some people, and we hope it will be drawing more. There have been 2 already held at Birch Meadow and at Joshua Eaton, and conversations have ranged from all different topics of relevance And the next one is going to be on April 27th from 8:30 to 9:30 a.m. And the place is going to be determined. I'm hoping I can make that one. I had a conflict for the last one. And I also wanted to say that the Blue Ribbon, I know that this will get a longer shout out, but I was able to attend, and we had our team chairs, some of our team chairs presenting, and I learned a lot about 504s, about student assessment, and it was really helpful to hear teachers being part of a workshop mentality, looking at and analyzing reports to move forward and have good conversations about it. And a shout out to the keynote speaker, Ron Susskind, who just was very powerful and gave me hope that I didn't know was there, and really reinforced our sidekicks, the people that enable children to succeed, who are our teachers. It was very, very powerful, and I understand we're hoping to get him back again for the community, so hopefully we can do that. I also wanted to quickly just say I had an amazing time at the Robockets first competition and spoke to some really inspiring students and mentors who choose to spend their time, both the students and the mentors, and I love the whole concept of the first competitions because the students are not just there for STEM, they're for everything. They have to report, they have to read, they have to research, they have to communicate, they have to teach each other, they have to teach younger children. And there was one student who actually was teaching me and three people that were up to my waist. And just an amazing presentation helping us all to understand the robots at hand. And this particular student was part of an outreach to a local company because they have to raise a lot of money because this money does not come from the Reading Public Schools. And so he not only achieved their purposes as a team going out to make a presentation that they prepared, he also ended up impressing them so much that he got a summer internship with that company, and others have gotten in, have gotten scholarships to college. It's a wonderful partnership, and it's very exciting that it is in our field house. And then once you enter our field house, it's exciting to every age that attends it, whether you're 5 or whether you're 70. You can't help but have your blood pressure go along with the pulse of the music and the lights and the excitement, the competition. So just a shout out to the Robockets, and they won first at that one and are moving on. So I'll let Dr. Doherty say more because he was a judge. Also a shout out to our schools. I was only able to go to one open house, but learned a lot at Coolidge's, and one classroom in particular was working on not only reading literature, but also how to discuss it in a polite and meaningful way, and respectful way, and I thought that was incredibly appropriate for these times. So it was not just about what they were learning, it was about how they were learning and how they facilitated their own learning with each other. So that was awesome, and I also saw the 8th and 9th grade band playing together, which was a room, I don't know how many kids, 80 to 90 kids in one room, all engaged in a March Madness competition and supporting each other. I guess I just kept feeling their core values. They were supporting each other. Some students in the competition didn't feel they did their best, and the support was palpable in the room for those too. So I just wanted to give a shout out on that. So thank you.
Sure. Any other committee or liaison reports?
Yeah, real quick one. The Reading Coalition of Substance Abuse met this month, and actually we took on two new associate members, Jennifer Hillary and Garrett Collins. And Garrett Collins is a Ooh, I think 2006.
2008.
2008, okay, graduate of Reading High. So I think that, well, unless Mike, yeah, no, probably makes him the youngest member of the board. So it's very exciting to get some new people, and I would just, there's been a lot of outreach from the community back to RACASA in the last couple of months, scouts, church groups, people reaching out saying, what can someone come and talk to us about X, Y, or Z, or how can we support RACASA's mission? So that's really good to see. It's because sometimes it just feels like the communication is just one way. So it's exciting to see people participate in that. And also the coalition sent a letter to the papers. The election tomorrow is important. There's a ballot question on there that the board of directors, you know, had some comments on. So I think, can we say vote?
I think we can say vote.
Get to the polls. Tomorrow is an election in our community, and people need to make sure they don't forget about that because it's a local election.
Thank you, Mrs. Webb. Yep. Any other liaison reports? I have one. The Recreation Committee met a couple of weeks ago. We had a public hearing. As part of our capital plan, we periodically revamp the playground structures all across the community, and it's time for the Hunt Playground, which is over on Pleasant Street, to be renovated. So the Recreation Committee created a subcommittee. They did a survey that got over 900 local responses, which is an incredible response rate. So I just wanted to update you that the process is underway to completely redo the Hunt Playground. So the recommendations, if you're interested, we're going to keep the footprint of the park the way it was. So if you imagine it in your head, you walk in, there's some swings on the right, there's the big play structure. There will be another brand new big play structure and swings. They're going to repair the existing fence, replenish the wood chip base. And this is one of only two tot lots in Reading for ages 2 to 5, and there was pretty strong consensus that it should remain that way. So it will continue to serve predominantly that age group. The new director of recreation, Jenna, was also very clear, and it's an important point. During difficult budget times, there's concern. Why are we redoing a playground? And I just want to make it clear that the capital budget is completely separate from the operating budget, and that we wouldn't want to go into an environment where we stop maintaining our buildings and playgrounds and fields and structures in order to support this operating budget, because we'd be setting up a situation in 5 to 10 years where, you know, the next school committee, the next board of selectmen, the next town meeting would have a horrible situation. So it really is, we manage capital really well in Reading. We have a set percentage of the budget it goes, and there's a plan, a multi-year long-term plan, and this is part of it. So I just want to make that point very clear. But it's going to be beautiful. It's really exciting. Anything else from the committee, Dr. Doxer?
Sorry, I neglected to mention a program done by the Human Relations Advisory Committee liaisons from the AWOD, A World of Difference program at the high school. They did an amazing craft and reading program at the public library. They had over 27 kids come and participate and stay the whole time. It was really an impressive show of our students making a difference in our community, and I'm really proud of them, every one of them.
Thank you. Anything else from the committee? All right, turn it over to the administration.
I think Mr. Martin has.
I just wanted to report out and say a little bit more also about our last in-service day, which was mentioned. We call it our Blueprint for Educational Excellence Institute, which was March 24th. So as you know, it's an in-service day for all of our staff, so they were all able to participate. And then, of course, we open it up also to registrants from outside our district. And this year, we actually hit an all-time high. We actually had to cut it off. We hit capacity, so we had in total about 900 educators in attendance, and all-time high for outside attendees of between 350 to 400 outside attendees. So we absolutely filled up our Performing Arts Center.
We did, because
there were some empty, there were some seats in there, but by the time we got started, they were kind of in the middle, and so, yeah, we need an usher, I guess. So it included people from all around our region, around New England, and even several from other states around the country, which is just a great collaboration. So we're currently been getting some feedback. We always use an online survey to get people's feedback about not only individual sessions they attended, but also the overall conference, to always see, you know, what worked, what didn't, how we could make it better if we do it again, and so forth. Before I got to go on, too, I just want to make sure I thank all of our staff who participated to help make it happen, both as attendees and presenters. I need to thank my administrative assistant, Lori Miller, for all of the work that she does to make this possible. Our facilities staff, custodians, kitchen crew, everybody. Couldn't do it without them. And of course, I want to thank Blue Ribbon Schools of Excellence, the nonprofit group, that we wouldn't be able to do this without their partnership. We certainly wouldn't be able to bring in such acclaimed speakers and presenters and attract people from around the region. And of course, it's another plus that we're able to provide this sort of thing at no cost to our district, mm-hmm. Which is amazing. And I just wanted to expand upon, as Dr. Doxer said, I mean, certainly one of the highlights that I'm still hearing about each and every day is our keynote speaker this year, which was Ron Susskind. He's a recipient of the Pulitzer Prize for stories that he wrote in the late 1990s with the Washington Post about an inner city school and some of the kids he met there in Washington, D.C., which he kind of interwove with the main story. He's also the author of several best-selling books. His latest is called Life Animated. I want to be sure I get it right. The subtitle, A Story of Sidekicks, Heroes, and Autism, which tells the story of his family's struggle over the last 20-some years with his son, who was diagnosed with regressive autism. And essentially, at about age two, they sort of saw their son disappear, lost speech and awareness and so forth. And telling their story and how they have since come to call this affinity therapy, which is taking a child's extreme interest. And in Owen's case, that was his son's, is his son's name, Owen, his love of Disney animated movies. And it was really through Disney animated movies that he refound his speech. He was literally watching and rewinding and all of that, studying facial expressions and the stories of how people connect and how emotions are shown. They had realized he had also taught himself to read by looking at the credits and reading. Just an amazing, amazing story. They had later found out that he had actually memorized the script of every single animated Disney animated movie and could use that in his education. So it's a very moving story. We had seen him, few of us, last summer, did an amazing job. We went to see the documentary that was made on this book. It premiered actually Kendall Square, and the family was there as well. By the way, the documentary was also nominated for an Academy Award. And so Owen, who is now in his, I think, early mid-20s, got to attend the Oscars, which was very, very exciting for him and the whole family. But I was so deeply moved that, I mean, right away in the fall, we started working with Blue Ribbon to see if we could arrange this, especially because the family's local. And we were able to do that, and so it was amazing. But one thing about the sidekicks, I just wanted to explain where that came from in the subtitle, and you referred to it as well. They found later, as Owen was progressing, that he was preoccupied even more with not the main characters of these movies, but all the sidekicks, you know, from Iago, the parent, the parrot in Aladdin, and so forth. Dozens and dozens of notebooks with drawings of those, and that he had written that no sidekick should be left behind, and he is the protector of sidekicks. And when asked, he explained that a sidekick's role is to help the hero fulfill his destiny. And in discussions I had with Mr. Susskind beforehand, he realized that he was about to enter a room of 900 sidekicks. That as educators, that's their role. That's what we do each and every day. And so many those educators have since said just how moving it was to feel validated. Some have said things, and even some of the online comments, simply the best keynote I've ever seen at any conference ever in my life, that they felt validated, and how wonderful and rewarding it was to feel thanked and appreciated for the sometimes unsung work that they do in being sidekicks. So anyway, thank you for that.
That's wonderful. Yep. It sounds like an amazing event.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just very quickly, what I neglected to say was thank you to Mr. Martin for enabling that huge conference to happen. Thank you very much.
As I said, it wouldn't happen without a lot of people, and my assistant, Lori, if you're out there watching. She keeps it all together. She makes sure that I'm making sure that I'm getting everything in on time and handling everything, and she's amazing. So thank you to everybody out there who made it happen.
And to you as well. Mm-hmm. Oh, I'm sorry, the other question.
So, Mr. Martin, just a quick follow-up question. So this is one of the five non-instructional days we have for
ED
for our teachers.
Days.
Okay. Yep. And then if you just give a quick one or two sentences how this helps our teachers teach our students better, maybe you could just make that connection for us. I obviously see the connection for students that may have autism and developing an awareness. Is there something beyond that, or does that capture it?
I should have said, the keynote happens in essentially we have an opening general session for everyone. That's why we use our Performing Arts Center that holds 900 or 901 people, I think. 901. And then the day is arranged with three concurrent sessions where people are able to choose from a variety of topics for the sessions, I believe, are about 1 hour, 5 minutes to 1 hour, 10 minutes, that ranges all different content areas and things. And that's one of the things, that's why we like to get the feedback too, is to see, you know, were there things that we missed? Are there things that we really want to offer? It also allows people to get professional development hours or professional development points in particular content areas as they need them for relicensing and stuff. So that's always something we're trying to do with that time.
So our teachers obtain PDP points for some of these sessions.
Yes, absolutely.
And we provide it in a way that they can pick from what's most relevant to their development.
Yeah, so I mean, it's the option. Some are getting the PDPs in more just general education by participating in it. Some are able to sort of target specific areas if they need PDPs or PD hours in particular areas.
Last question. And then people that are out of district pay a tuition to go to this? Is that
when
you say it was
small registration
neutral?
To be able to come and attend. Yeah.
Okay.
And that defrays costs.
It does.
So that defrays the cost for the Reading teachers.
Yes.
So we pay the Reading teachers' salary. They all attend, but they get the benefit of the PDP points.
Yeah, so in terms of the,
and then other
know,
people are paying
the day,
the rest.
The lunches, the speakers, all of that is
thank you.
Through the cost.
Sorry for reading the mind.
No, you got it.
And this is done without pulling them out of their classrooms.
Because everyone else was shoveling snow.
For their courses.
Right. I should also add, too, thank you to many of the businesses in the community. They were in the program, but many of them donated some prizes to give out at the brief closing session, food, pizza, different things like that for lunches, things like that. So, yeah, our gratitude to them as well.
Thank you, Mr. Martin.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry, Mrs. Webb. In the Performing Arts Center for Ron Susskind, and the teachers, there were teachers in front of me that I don't think were from our district, but anyway, they were just like going through the thing going, there's so many amazing things to choose from. I can't even pick. There's just so many amazing things to choose from. And it seemed to be, you know, people were just, they were just trying to trade off, well, if you go to that, and then you can tell me about it, and I'll go to this. And, you know, that's a good conference when you can't decide which of the concurrent sessions you really feel are going to be most valuable to you.
I will say that opening session, people were literally, I'm not exaggerating, laughing and crying. They were so moved. It was palpable, the emotion you could feel in that room. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay, are you?
I'm good. I'm presenting.
You're good. You've got a lot to do.
Yeah. Don't worry about
it. I have several things. So first, I just wanted to announce that I am releasing several executive session minutes, which are included on your agenda, going all the way back to December 22nd, 2003. So those are listed there, and they've been released. Also, under information and correspondence, you see that there are several emails from citizens and other members of the community regarding a variety of topics. As we talked about, I believe, two meetings ago, any email that is now sent to the committee and responded to by the chair, we're going to be publicly putting in the packet. This is a similar practice as done for Board of Selectmen meetings. do want to take a moment, and I want to brag a little bit about our district. And I think that this community should be very proud of the things that are going on in our schools. I did touch a little bit upon this in my remarks to the teachers at the Blue Ribbon Conference. But upon reflecting what has happened in this district in the last month, there's a lot of great things happening here in the Reading Public Schools. So I want to just touch, some of you have touched upon them. I know the students talked a little bit about, but also I just want to touch about, because all of this happened in essentially 1 month. There are things that happen year-round, but a lot of things happened in 1 month here in our school district. So first of all, a lot of things happened with science and technology. So we had three secondary schools participated in either the middle school or the high school state Olympiad. Did very well, and as you know, Coolidge is going to move on to the national Olympiad at Wright State. We held our first Lego League exhibition at Endicott College, part of our extended day program this year. The extended day program took over the first Lego League this year. At the request of the volunteers who had been running the first Lego League for several years. And we felt that it was a natural fit for our extended day program to run that as an after-school program. Mm-hmm. So through the hard work of Sandy Calandrella and her staff, they took this head on, and several teams, both at the elementary and middle school level, happened throughout the entire year, and they had their exhibition at Endicott College. So they worked with Endicott College a few Saturdays ago, and they had over 100 students participate in this exhibition. And Endicott provided some prizes and things like that for the winners. I think the Endicott sweatshirts and water bottles and things like that. So, kudos to them. And I know the students were very excited at that. And then we had, that's the feeders group. And then we had the high school group, which held its regional tournament here and did very, very well. And Mrs. Doxer talked a little bit about that. They not only won the entire tournament here with their alliance, but they also won the Engineering Inspiration Award, which automatically qualify them to the New Englands, which happened this weekend at UNH. If they do well there, they have the opportunity to go to the Worlds in St. Louis in a few weeks after that. So, again, kudos to that group, our high school robotics team, the coaches, the volunteers, the sponsors. There's a lot. It's truly a team effort. So that's just science. Then we had music. Our jazz band won 2 gold medals during the month of March. The first one was at the regional jazz band competition, which was held here at Reading Memorial High School. And then they went to Norwood High School for the States, and they won a gold medal there, which qualified them to participate at the Hatch Shell on Mother's Day. So they will be playing at the Hatch Shell on Mother's Day as one of the best jazz bands in the state. It is not easy to get a gold medal as a jazz band at the high school level. So congratulations to Joe Mulligan and the students for that. We also had several students in grades 6 through 9 participate at the highest level that they can participate in chorus and in instrumental at the Northeast Junior Districts, which was held in Wakefield a few weeks ago. So we had 32 students in grades 6 through 9 participate in that. Then we move on to drama. We had 2 shows during the month of March. Parker held Once Upon a Silent Junior, a musical, and the high school had 1776. Both very difficult shows to do, great costumes, great music. I want to congratulate the cast and crew and the advisors for the great work that they did. And then we had art. We had several students at the middle and high school have their artwork honored. High school students had their artwork displayed at the 6th Congressional Art Show, which was at Montserrat College. And then several Reading students had artwork displayed at the State Transportation Building as part of Youth Art Month, which just finished up last week. all of this has been captured in these newsletters that we send out, the Pathways newsletters. You can get all the information in there. But I just think it's, you know, when you combine that with Blue Ribbon, you combine that with Arts Fest, which starts Wednesday night. You combine that with Read Across America, which went from preschool through elementary, and the great things that happened during the month of March with Read Across America, and the work that we're doing at with literacy in the elementary. There's a lot of great things happening in this district that we need to be proud of and we need to celebrate. So I just want to thank again teachers, administrators, advisors, coaches, anyone that's a part of these things, thank you, because I think it's something that makes us unique from other school districts. So that's one, my first part of the report. The second part I wanted to talk about, I don't think it's a separate agenda item. Actually, it is, so I'll wait. And that's the FY18 budget, yeah. But that's a separate agenda item, so I'll wait on that.
All right. Thank you for that, all that positive news. It's good to be reminded of all the good that's going on. Mr. Bobbin.
A question on the superintendent's update. So will students be taking any tests on Passover or Good Friday this year?
No, they will not. And in my newsletter for the last 2 weeks, they're actually, that has been captured as well.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Anything else from the committee?
Well, no, I should clarify that. Not every day of Passover, just the first day of Passover.
The day that,
the first day,
the one day that's,
in the
that's indicated in the school letter.
Because yeah. Passover is 8 days.
Correct. So. Right. Thank you.
Yep, Dr. Cool. Knox.
I actually had some questions about that. There will be, because there is testing the day after the second Seder, which is not the first day, so it's still following the accommodation policy. The challenge was, I've had this discussion, the challenge was that a lot of things in the district moved around to accommodate Passover. From the trip to Canada, Coolidge trip to Canada, also the District Arts Festival moved so that it did not leave kids out that would be otherwise at Seder's. And the window with vacation made it very difficult to avoid the day after the second Seder, but the accommodations, children and their parents should approach their teachers, because if that is not a good day for them to take those exams, then they can rearrange. It's not optimal, but I was really impressed by how the district tried to accommodate all the nuances. I know how hard it is to move Arts Fest and to move a trip, and I really appreciated that, both as a school committee member and as a person living Jewishly in this community. It meant a lot to me that effort was put into accommodating the needs.
And it should be said that we plan to address this topic in a couple of months when we get through the budget season. So we will be looping back to the accommodations policy. So right. It's a and discussion that's continuing on through this committee.
And there, we had discussed that there would be a subcommittee to meet about this.
Yep.
So question for my colleague. So Linda, you're satisfied with the way the policy has been rolled out?
We're now getting into an off-agenda discussion.
Okay.
You had a question.
Just want to make sure questions are answered. Thank you.
No, but my point is definitely get it on a future agenda item. There's a plan for that. But I don't want to go too far down the path where the public wasn't notified we'd be having that discussion.
Thank you for the update, Dr. Dardy.
Do you have anything else, or do you want to dive into the quarterly financials?
No, I'm all set for now.
Okay. So Actually, quarterly.
Student service.
I think we're doing a couple other things quickly, though. Quarterly
yes,
personnel.
Yes, the quarterly reports are before the presentation.
I know. I can't wait to hear from Carolyn, too. So quarterly personnel. It's a short report.
Yes. So in your packet, sorry, that's me. In your packet is the quarterly personnel report. And let me just pull it up because I want to. I want to thank Jen Bovee for putting this report together. As you can see, there isn't a lot of personnel actions that have happened during this month. There you go. Most of what has been happening has been due to either a retirement, unfilled positions that have been vacant for a while have been now filled after being vacant. We did have one person resign, really due to the fact that this person's position was part of the budget reductions for FY18 and left to go teach in another district. We also had a fill-in of a retirement and an internal transfer and some paraeducators that were hired as well. So again, there wasn't a lot of personnel actions that were going on during this time. Fourth quarter will be similar. Really, the major hiring will start in the summer. And our first quarter report in the fall will capture all of that information.
Any questions from the committee? Mr. Robinson.
So did Mr. Strout leave?
No. Mr. Strout did, that was an internal transfer. So there was a retirement, and there was an internal transfer to another, he internally transferred to the retirement, the retired position.
So he's still in the math department?
He's teaching, he's part math and part technology integration specialist now.
Anything else? Yeah, Mr. Paul.
I just had a question about the, some of these, the vacancies have pretty, you have two significant figures on your FTE splitting here. So it's like 0.57, 0.49, 0.84. How typical is that that a position is broken up into multiple FTE? Is that very common? I mean, just ballpark, is that unusual?
The paraeducators. Those are paraeducators.
Understood. But the splitting into, so if people see an FTE in a budget, for example, how often is that one body, one FTE, as opposed to one person being split into multiple FTEs?
A 0.6 is one person.
One person working 0.6 of
yeah,
what they
0.6.
Could be working.
And I believe the committee asked us to change it this way last time, so that's
yeah,
why
no, this
I,
is
I'm,
fine.
I'm curious about this question. Paraeducators are hourly employees.
Okay.
So that where teachers are more, you know, FTEs are more, they're measured more in FTEs. The request was made last time by the committee to go to FTEs for all employees, which is why we did that.
So
your paraeducators are more hourly employees. So you've got 30-hour paraeducators. You've got sometimes 15-hour. It just depends on the need, whether it be special education or tutor or whatever the job is that they're required to do.
So when we say vacancy for a fraction of an FTE, that means there's that many hours of whatever would be a normal work week that
Correct.
We're not filling.
Correct.
And does that just create regenerated cash to the budget then if it was budgeted, if we have a vacancy?
The position is, most of the time, is budgeted unless it's a required special education position that was not originally budgeted for. But yes.
So these vacancies where we have somebody's name where they're replacing, that just means we're not replacing. I'm just trying to make sure that people understand what this table means. So we have a number of vacancies here. We have someone's name, it says replacing them, and it's just vacant.
Correct.
That means
right
that
now
you're just
says,
not rehiring to refill.
They've been posted and they've not been filled
yet. You just
yet.
Haven't hired yet.
Correct.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the committee? Okay. Thank you, Dr. Doherty. Can you talk a little bit about the budget?
Yes. Mrs. Dowd has put together a very detailed and comprehensive update that she's going to highlight for you.
Thank you.
So within the package that we provided is the update that is as of March 31st, and I made a couple of slight changes on the number version. What I did was I grouped it so that it matches the same order and groupings that we had in the budget book since we just went through that project process, mm-hmm. so that it flows similarly to how we did that, and also added one of the suggestions from Mrs. Webb was to put totals for the district wide so that everything sort of hangs together, so hopefully this format makes it flow a little bit easier for folks. We currently are projecting an unencumbered balance of just over $259,000 through the end of the year. And what we did as part of this process is we went through, projected all of our current FTEs, as well as we do continue to keep the open positions in there that we are actively recruiting on. You will see that we did add, as part of the November town meeting They did approve the additional $40,000 to be added to the facilities budget, so that has been reflected in here as well. And we will be continuing to monitor these balances throughout the end of the year. As we noted as part of the Finance Committee meetings, we are hopeful that if this the numbers do continue the way they are, that we'll be able to utilize some of this year's savings to offset some of the purchases we're putting on hold for next year, so the technology and the building based items. So we will actually be looking at this almost every couple of weeks over the next couple of months to gauge where we are. So a couple of the highlights, the administrative cost center is one that we have talked about throughout this process as well as the budget process. The surplus in there represents salary savings for the position that had been budgeted and then subsequent to the budget was decided not to fill it based upon the current financial conditions. Within the regular day cost center, that is where the significant bulk of the savings are projected. The majority of that is the salary savings. One item to note is that where we do have some of the openings, even if it's within the paraeducators, we do have instances where we have substitutes, whether they're daily, long-term, short-term, or other paraeducators filling in to cover some of those. So it's not always a one-for-one change in the budget. Mrs. Wilson and I spent a great deal of time going over the special education budget. We've gone through very similar to what we did when we built the FY18 budget, is we've gone line item by line item. We've also looked at all of the out-of-district tuition in the associated transportation and have gone individual by individual to project the rest of the year. We do still have some unanticipated built within the forecast as we're continuing to work through items as they come up. As we've done historically, to the extent we do have additional funding left over, we will look to potentially prepay some of the FY18 tuitions to the extent we have that. So we actually have set up meetings every 2 weeks for the rest of the year to go through all of these items and make sure nothing mm-hmm. is happening that we hadn't anticipated, so we can adjust for that. The areas where you'll notice the biggest changes also tie into all of the discussions we had during the budget season, which is mainly within the district-wide cost center. You'll notice that right now extracurricular and athletics are currently projected to have deficit balances, and that is largely the result of the revolving accounts. As we had discussed during the budget process, there were three revolving accounts that are currently projected to go negative, which we wouldn't allow them to happen. So this projection includes us adjusting those offsets, which are very close to what we are reducing the offsets for next year. We actually are working very closely with use of school properties to make sure we're collecting every penny we can collect. We're meeting with them to make sure we're monitoring that. Also, as part of the athletics, the other item we had talked about were the pool rates, where half the season we had the old rate, the other half, mm-hmm. the girls, we had the old rate, the boys was the new rate, so we also are reflecting that in here as well. So that is really the significant change you see in those areas. And then the same within facilities, as we have adjusted the offset within that account as well to reflect where we think we may be. But we will not know until much closer to the end of June as to what the actual offset would be. So at this point, my recommendation was not to look for or request cost center transfers until we are closer to the end of the year and we have a much better sense of where the revolving accounts are going to be. So if we get additional funds in or something else happens, we can just come to the committee once towards the end of the year and ask to do the cost center transfers. I thought that would be a cleaner approach, and then we can really speak to where we came in for the year. And part of what we want to make sure we do is position ourselves very well for next year to be able to take the offsets that we've budgeted. So that's why we're meeting with folks now and really closely monitoring the balances. And what we have also done based upon recommendations and suggestions that we had received from the committee is, as part of the memo, we have listed some of the risks that we're continuing to monitor. We have handed some of this out
and we did talk about it at the Finance Committee. What I did do in here was reorder it a little bit to put the ones where we're actually experiencing some of the items this year with leaves of absence, where we've had to pay multiple people. Within the Special Education Center, cost center, you'll notice that we have had some items go negative in there, and that's where we've had to contract out services to cover leaves of absence. So we tried to put them in order to say these are the items we're actually monitoring and tracking this year from a risk standpoint, and then we'll look to build this out in future quarters, almost to make it sort of a heat map, if you will, of items where we are seeing we're in the red. These are items we're tracking, but we haven't actually incurred, so I can put those in the green, in items where we're monitoring, they're in the yellow right now. So I thought that might be an area we can look to expand some of this, as especially as we go into the FY18, to really track where we are and how we're reallocating.
That'd be a great direction to go in.
That's all I have.
Mr. Robinson had a question.
So on the regular day budget, the narrative says primarily the surplus primarily due to turnover and savings and salaries associated with new hires. Are those new hires that happened in September or for the beginning of the school year? Or?
It would be cumulative through the entire year for anyone that we had similar savings earlier in the year when we had done this. So we continue to track it if we have anyone who does turn over mid-year, or if we have anyone that's potentially out on an unpaid leave for part of the year, where we, even if we have substitutes, we may have a little bit of savings in it. But the bulk of this would have occurred earlier in the year.
It's also vacant positions that we haven't hired that were budgeted for. So we've had a few of those this year.
So the numbers readout is after that really good summary that you provided, that you just kind of walked us through. So there's this one page here that has all the numbers from last quarter. So they're cumulative for the year at the end, right? So we have about 259,000 projected, and then the budget in the beginning. So I read this about a 0.6%.
Correct. That was in the memo. It's a 0.6%.
So return. We're projecting that we're going to be within 0.6% of our budget.
Yes, with the caveat that, to the extent, not to interrupt, that these, we'll track them throughout, that the goal would be to purchase technology and other items that we are actually putting on hold in the budget next year.
We're cutting FY18.
What we said to financial, yes, at Finance Committee last year. The target would be to be able to spend about 150 of this, so we are not anticipating returning the full amount back to the town at the end of the year.
So this is great, like everybody's reading my mind. So that was my next question, was actually, could you briefly tell, for people who watched those Finance Committee meetings where Jean talked on behalf of the school committee and talked about, she was talking about FY17 money, to be clear. We had one meeting where we talked about, sorry, Jean.
No, go ahead.
Mischaracterizing this, let me know. But
I'll jump in.
We talked about FY18 budget in the first FinCom meeting with school committee president, and then the second FinCom meeting, we talked about FY17 budget. This is the 17 piece. And could you just briefly tie in your work here to that discussion? So is the any way you'd like, just very briefly, so people can connect those two dots, and then if I have questions, I'll follow up.
I'll steal some of your
So this is the next piece that I was going to talk about.
That's where we're going.
Yeah, okay, I was going to talk about that next.
So okay, and then one other point. Well, I'll let you get to that. These risk factors, I wanted to, at a high level, characterize. You gave us two sets of what you called risks in your memo, in the packet, and so you have direct risk and indirect risks. Kind of reading through these, I had the impression that there were two types of risk. So the risk, as I understand, is that the actual numbers, the projections, wouldn't be the actual numbers at the end of the year, right? And so most of these risks seem to be risks either that we would spend more money than we think we will, and that could be legal requirements, could be student need, whatever. And then the other set of risks is a risk around student services. So for instance, classroom size, other things. Is that a fair way to two buckets to put these in, and am I missing anything with that
it
abstraction?
Is what we were, the first set is really a dollar for dollar. You can really attribute it and say, if you're paying two people, here is the cost. The second set is, it could have an indirect cost where if classroom sizes, I'll use that, and please correct me if I,
yep.
If classroom sizes start to grow and we need to bring on
either additional resources, have somebody else in the classroom. It's items we would be able to discuss, and we can't definitively point to it and say this would cost this. Some of the others are changing regulatory environment, which near and dear to my heart throughout all of my career. Those are items that can take away from potentially some of your day-to-days where items that we might need to be spending time on, we have to divert our attention. And then some of the others are more from coverage. So I'll use myself as an example. I get hit by a bus. You might have to bring in a consultant to cover my position because there isn't somebody out here in the central office that could just step in and do it. I will look both ways before crossing the street tonight. So some of those, we just wanted to put out there to say that these are items that we're cognizant of that today don't have a cost associated with it. But if something were to happen, you could find yourself in a situation where you have to contract out these services, which we would not have contemplated. Does that help?
It does. So
sort of the indirect.
It does. I'll just make one final comment, let other people ask their questions. Just so to highlight two examples of that. One on the cost side is that we've had to, people are not, have a leave of absence, for example, and to bring their skill set to our district may take more than one person, right? Or a higher paid person.
Yeah.
And that's on the cost side. And then I just want to point out the last thing here that got my attention was that under the current projections that we have projections that have middle school class sizes at one of the middle schools exceeding 30 per student. So I just wanted to highlight that, that given these numbers and these resources, this is the level of service is changing. We're having higher class sizes than we have in the past.
Yes.
Thanks.
So I just want to, this is good information, but I guess my, a little bit concerned. So this is a run rate. This is nothing to do. This isn't anything we've done as a result of the FinCom where we're going back. And so, you know, it's a little disconcerting that, you know, there was so much angst in the budget process and now we're, you know, we're kind of on track with what we need. It'd be one thing if, you know, this was a result of some adjustments we made now, but this goes back to the on a run rate back to the beginning of the year.
I think that some of the changes were we have brought down, the run rate would have been probably slightly higher at the beginning of the year. We have had some additional costs come into special ed when we had done this earlier in the year. Special education had been projected to have a surplus. It's now projected to have a deficit. And we are continuing to monitor it because I feel like every time I put these numbers down, I find out that additional services are needed. And I think the other big piece is that has changed the number is right setting the offsets.
The offsets, yeah.
So that sort of brought the number down from what we had shown you 3 months before we had done the budget process. But we are hopeful that we've captured everything in here, that we will be on target to be at about the 0.6%. But again, the caution is that special education, not to, I feel like I'm picking on special education. That is an ever-changing day-by-day situation where
that's always one of our most volatile situations.
Yeah. Yeah. When you have high legal requirements, you have to.
Yep.
So I just want to point out one other thing. This FY17 budget, Dr. Darty, you started building this back in October of 15, right? 18 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
Ago,
yes.
So.
All right. And then school committee, I was here that night. That was January of 16 that this was approved.
Mm-hmm.
And here we are 18 months after it started at 0.6% variance. So it's no doubt that you need to have some built-in flexibility with this document definitely explains. But that's a long road.
I agree. It's impressive. It shows tight management. I would just want to clarify something that you said, Ms. Dowd. I'm sure I heard you, but I just want to repeat it because it's near and dear to my heart. The offsets that you're anticipating being problematic this year and maybe having to make adjustments to solve them, I thought I heard you say they are tracking to be around what we budgeted for FY18. So it sounds like a fairly high level of confidence that the projections for FY18 are more sustainable.
Yes.
Excellent. That's great.
Thank you.
Anything else from the committee?
So great job, Gilba.
Yeah.
Amazing. I'm just looking at the rise, just for clarity's sake. I think I know the answer to this, but so we're in the negative in the rise program, but that we have a revolving account that we offset that, or no?
We do. The reason that this one has actually been in the negative since the beginning of the school year, this is the result of increase in enrollment where we needed to add a teacher as well as a paraeducator. So this was an item that came about after we finalized the budget, but really at the beginning of this fiscal year. We do take an offset as well. That's another one. As of right now, I haven't adjusted the offset that we take. I've kept that one consistent, but that's another area that we'll revisit at the end of the year to see how much. But we were comfortable with the offset we're taking. We've increased the rates next year, which will allow us to have more flexibility in the offset. So it's one we would monitor, where I would not want to increase it too much this year if there was a risk of not being able to sustain it next year. So it all becomes part of looking at the balance in the account and where we're at.
We added a sub-separate classroom this year, which required mm-hmm. the extra teacher and paraeducator. That's the reason for the deficit. Cost.
But I guess, so we do have something to go back to, and like you said, take the offset and balance it out. So we have a revolving account that has more than enough money to cover what we've expended. Is that correct?
I would not go so far as to say we have the 100,000 in there that we could take out. We'd need to look at where we are at the end of the year. I haven't, that one we were comfortable with the offset we were taking, knowing we were still
the bottom
going
line's
to be
in a positive position.
You wouldn't want to change the offset this year and then set up a challenge for
correct.
Next year.
Correct.
You want to make sure the fund is sustainable.
I'm trying to look towards this year as well as next year and not potentially create instances
sorry.
Next year where we may not have the ability.
But Mr. Robinson's point is right. We're in the positive overall, so we can do a cost center transfer if necessary. And this is an example of one of the risks you articulated, changes in staffing need, unanticipated changes in staffing need due to student needs. Passed a budget, didn't know that we would have that population come in, and you have to, and mm-hmm. there's a clear explanation for the increased costs. That's regulated.
People want to know what encumbered means. It's a quick way to explain that.
That is basically just looking at our actual expenses and known expenditures for the rest of the year. So it's basically taking all of your run rates, all of your personnel, projecting for the rest of the year, as well as all of your building expenses and everything that you know is going to occur.
Incurred but not spent.
Yes.
Much like your mortgage.
Anything else from the committee?
Yeah. Question. Would there ever be a way that we could track, it's going to vary from year to year, but how much money is actually, you know, what when we have these types of situations where we have to replace somebody, is there a way to track that during the year? I imagine there would be, but I think it would be important to have that data available at some point.
So is just to clarify the difference between outgoing salary and incoming salary, so changes in
so as Dr. Jardy uses an example, someone's out on maternity leave and we have to pay a substitute, and we also have to pay the maternity leave person a teacher salary as well for the period of time they're allowed. Does that make sense? I'm trying to
mm-hmm.
okay. Well, we have so much data. What would we? I would think we have that. It's just, I can't imagine with all the numbers that we have and the things that you keep track of and personnel that we wouldn't be able to have that. But what would be just tracking that number itself as the cost of, just the total
yeah,
cost
sure.
of
well,
it?
Well, I think, yeah, because we often get questioned, you know, well, you have X amount of dollars at the beginning of the year that is, you know, unattached to a particular person, the salary account, you know, like $350,000, let's say. I forget exactly what that's. When you have teachers that are resigning or, you know, changing positions, people resigning and you're hiring people at less money. So we have a balance at the beginning of the year, correct?
Yes.
Right.
It doesn't always work exactly that way. Sometimes the people we're hiring are more expensive.
Yeah, I understand that. But I'm just saying, I think we get questioned as to, you know, we have that funding available. What are we doing with it? And, you know, just to make sure that people understand that, you know, there are things that come up during the course of the school year that, you know, you need to account for. So, you know, that funding can be used in that particular circumstance. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense to you?
I think the outgoing and ingoing is a relatively clean way because you have person A and person B. I think where, not that we couldn't, I think where the other ones, which it would just take a little bit more process would be, is if you have a person out and you have coverage, whether it be you could have multiple teachers, you could have five teachers covering for one teacher, splitting up classes, you could have paraeducators that are getting moved from the para to a classroom, getting paid contractually what their rates are. You can have a short-term sub, a long-term sub. So there are
sometimes we're hiring two people to do the same job because they don't have the skill set, or three people, school psychologists, that's happened a couple times this year.
So we could broad bucket, I think, person by person, it would be tracing it through because we do have instances where we may have three or four teachers covering for one teacher that's on leave depending upon what their open schedules are.
But there is a cost to that.
Mm-hmm. There is a cost to that.
Right. And we'd be able to track that. No, we wouldn't. That would be a challenge.
We would be able to track it. It would be a man.
It would be a very time-consuming process.
There isn't.
Yeah.
Because we don't capture it in a different bucket per se. So if it was me and I was covering classes, it would be part of my salary that's going through payroll. So we have time cards to accumulate the extra time. So we could go through and manually accumulate it.
I can't see. I guess I would really like to see. I don't vote for doing more manual effort. I think we have an amazing amount of data here. I think we should try to understand really exactly what data we're looking for before we ask Gail.
Let me just explain it. So at the beginning of the year, typically, I mean, I've tracked this, there's funds available because of teacher retirements, teacher resignations. So Dr. Doherty said sometimes it doesn't work out exactly. We hire somebody that costs more. But what I've seen, particularly lately, last three or four years, is available funds. Somewhere, I can't remember off the top of my head what they were, but I used those figures when I made a suggestion. We were discussing revamping our budget to make sure that we could bring back the middle school language teachers. So people question, why do we have that money? How those funds, you know, what are they being used for? So if you can track it, then you can say, here's where we use it. Does that make sense?
It does. I guess I'm just thinking what we're talking about here is that, so for the FY18 budget, we're setting the budget. You're currently tracking, keeping track of any retirements employees flowing out of the district that you might already know about are going to impact FY18. Then what you're saying is when we start the school year for the beginning of FY18, we just need to know what those positions were that you plan to have in the budget that you don't have in the budget, and what is it costing you to replace them. But isn't that sort of what we're looking at here with the, wouldn't that be reflected in this personnel report where we are looking at?
Yes, for example, this year, to answer your question, I think we captured this during the budget discussions. We had to hire a teacher for Wood End, a teacher for Joshua Eaton, a 0.5 team chair to make a full-time team chair at Joshua Eaton. So there right there is 2.5 positions that, and also we're providing more support at Joshua Eaton for their after-school program, for tutorial support. So that's where that money is going.
Right, and I understand that. But what I'm saying is if you could put that in a separate bucket, all right, so people understand, these are the costs that, you know, were unexpected that now we have to, you know, come up with. Does that make sense? I'm not so sure why this doesn't make sense, because we get asked continually to be transparent, and I'm asking if we can make that more transparent for people that don't understand that document.
I'm not asking, I'm not saying not to be transparent. I think, all I am trying to say is, it seems to me that we actually already have this data. We look at the data now. Maybe John just has it in his head, or Gail has it on a different report, and we just need to put it together. I think it's important that we have the data. I don't, the detail that Ms. Dowd was just talking about in terms of, you know, you have a high school teacher that goes out, I hope we're not looking at time cards of five different people, you know, over 3 months, and then substitutes. I don't know how complex, it doesn't seem to me that it should be that complex to understand what that is.
So,
and I would think it's really part of, if we were doing a personnel update, these kinds of things would be reflected in the personnel
And we did reflect it at the last personnel, so, not this one, because we didn't really,
okay,
there wasn't any new positions, but the last one we did.
Right,
we
but I'm talking about the entire year. So if you go back into fiscal year 2017 after July 1st and make that figure known, this is how much money we had to come up with that was unanticipated.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, I think it's just a good figure to have that I think people would benefit from and understand when we get questioned as to whether or not, you know, you're starting the school year with an extra $200,000 or $250,000 because of turnover.
Nice.
Where does that money go? People are wondering. So that's what I'm just going to say. You can say that if you can explain, you know, as close as you can.
Mm-hmm.
You're not going to be looking at time cards. Teachers don't use time cards, but you might be looking at time cards for paraprofessionals. But as far as teachers' salaries, like Dr. Daugherty just stated, I'm not sure what is there a question, Dr. Daugherty?
No, I'm about to ask a question.
And how, Mr. Robinson has actually been waiting very patiently, and I'll say I'd like to wrap up this discussion because we're now kind of falling behind agenda. I think it's an interesting point and one to kind of contemplate. Is there a way to get our arms around that? But Mrs. Webb, I hear what you're saying, and I'm very sensitive to Gail's time. So if it's something that, yeah, we can get that for you really easily, then let's have that conversation. The more effort and manual work it is, the more I think we need to have a discussion about, do we absolutely need this data or can we not get it through here? So I think it can be a continuing ongoing discussion. Mr. Robinson.
So we get these on a quarterly basis.
Yes.
So
yeah.
Maybe I'm just thinking, so we get this one and the next one we'll get in June and September.
Yeah, you'll probably get it July after the fiscal year closes.
So maybe it's a good idea to get this snapshot right before we start to talk about the FY19 budget. So we'll know where we are.
Mm-hmm.
So it would be off that regular quarterly calendar, but it's a good time to look at it because then we'll kind of have a feel for, you know, maybe there's where we get some adjustments to the budget. Just a thought for one.
High level, what I've attempted to do in the memo, I think I was trying to cover some of your points, is talk about some of the areas where we had regular day transportation. The bus contract was higher than we thought, so we needed to fund that, the offsets, some of the special education. So I've tried to do it sort of smattered throughout the memo as I go through each one, but we might be able to look at more holistically bubbling some of those.
Oh, that was a good memo.
Yeah.
I mean, extremely detailed, but I'm just asking for a specific
snapshots
that we can use that when we're questioned.
I think it was one of the most detailed memos I've seen.
Really? Quick, and it's quick, but I think it'll be helpful. Gail, the memo, just to tie together two things that I was able to piece together. If you look down the numbers at the over-under, since mm-hmm. it's basketball day, talk about over-unders. Every place that it's over, in parentheses, that just starting on paragraph 5 of your memo, so if people have questions, you start with that 29K at Coolidge here, and that's explained in paragraph 5, and I won't go through the rest, but if people want to follow the places where there's numbers like the 68K, the 153K, et cetera, that are significant variances, those are explained, each explained in your memo,
mm-hmm.
And you can follow right along to understand why those numbers are what they are. So I just wanted to point that out to people, that there's a good explanation of that. Thank you.
There was, and I think you made a good point that bears repeating, which is that we are on track right now to hit our budget within 0.6%, a budget that was established 18 months ago. So that bears repeating. Thank you for that memo and that update. That was FY17. talk a little bit about where we're at for FY18. And Dr. Doherty, before you start, I know you're going to reference what you published in the Pathways blog about this.
Yes.
I thought it was a really thorough and a very good explanation. And you've done a really good job, I think, throughout the last several months of updating the community about what has been an unusually complex budget process. So thank you for that.
Thank you. So it has, yeah, it has obviously been a very complex budget process. And, you know, I don't want to go back and rehash everything that we've talked about since January. But we were at a point with the Finance Committee a few weeks ago where we were presenting the school committee budget to the Finance Committee. And then the following week, Ms. Borowski, myself, Mrs. Dowd presented a way that we could help address the different pieces of the school committee budget proposal, which would minimize the amount of free cash that was used. So the couple parts to this. The first part is the science piece, which was part of the $588,000 that the school committee had voted on in the budget. So the $150,000 that was set aside for the next phase of the science implementation, that is actually going to be addressed in FY17 at April town meeting. So at the same finance committee meeting that we were at when the finance committee took the votes, the town manager showed a list of transfers from various departments, which one of those was $150,000 for the science. So if town meeting does approve that transfer, there will be $150,000 in FY17 that will be used for the next phase of science implementation. And as it says in the memo that I sent out, what we're looking at is focusing in areas of K-2, 7, 8, 9, 12 for the next piece. So that takes care of the $150,000. What remains is $438,000. And so where it gets a little bit complicated now, to be able to restore the 7 FTEs, which is the equivalent of $438,000, the first piece is that the school department did request an additional $100,000 of cash reserves to be allocated. So to explain, the Finance Committee had originally approved in October $1.2 million of free cash for the total FY18 budget, town and schools. Only $1.1 million had been used up to that point. So the additional $100,000 was part of the original $1.2 million. It was not on top of the $1.2. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an important point to make. So the $100,000 is part of it. The other piece, the next piece, is that since January, we have had some additional retirements, which have caused some turnover in savings that we are using historical analysis at that point. We also are going to receive some savings from our two administrative turnovers, which is Principal Joshua Eaton and Mrs. Batsasiatani. She's retiring, and we wish her the best of luck in her retirement, but also the RISE preschool director. So through that, and through the teacher turnover retirement, it was about a $90,000 from that piece. And that's really based on historical analysis. That's what we're basing it on at this point. In addition to that, we are holding back, actually we're reducing the purchasing of technology and our building-based budgets by $150,000. Our hope is, which ties back to the financial report that you just saw, that we'll be able to purchase that technology and the building-based budget materials in FY17, so that $150,000 will be used for that purpose. So we're going to be doing more prepaying of material than we have in the past. So that brings us to the last piece, which I believe is $98,000. The town manager has committed $132,000 of holdbacks in the FY18 budget on the town side that would offset the $98,000. So when it's all said and done, we're able to piece together for 1 year the ability to restore the 7 middle school teachers. So I don't know. The memo that was put in the blog and put in the newsletter captures all of this in detail.
Thank you. Oh, yes.
So just to clarify then, the currently the view of FY17 with the $259,000 positive or 0.6% does not have that like $150,000 encumbered in
that.
That
is correct. It's not encumbered.
So
if everything continues,
along
the projection,
we would have the $150,000 and still potentially be returning 0.3% or something of free cash to the town. But we did say we were really clear that night with the financial committee that we don't think that they should expect the 1% regeneration that they have come to see from us in terms of free cash. So, or our return of our budget, because I like to think we've done a really outstanding job. I've always not understood when you return on such a big budget and you return 1%, people look at that as you're doing a poor job, because yes, you have more money and you have an opportunity cost of money. But I think given that you're doing this 18 months in advance, given all of the changes that we can see around student services and student needs, I frankly think returning 1% over on average over the last 10 years is truly that a good job. But that, okay, I just wanted to make sure that the 0.6% we're looking at right now doesn't have the 150 of FY17 that we are hoping to support the FY18 technology and building budgets with.
That's correct. Okay. There is another important point that I forgot to mention, is that, you know, all of this is being put together from a variety of sources. It's a 1 year fix. And we are still cutting 10.9 positions and close to $1 million.
And raising fees.
And raising fees.
Yeah. In pet rides.
So we are both very concerned about this budget moving forward, and we made that very clear to the Finance Committee.
And I think everyone in that room understood that this is a budget unlike previous budgets in terms of sustainability.
So just building on a point that Elaine made before, Dr. Daugherty, and maybe Gail, this is for you, the $150,000 of additional FY17 money that was discussed at Finance Committee as being the additional money that comes out of this 259 that you have here in your projection that we just talked about.
Not the science 150, the 150. Mm-hmm.
It's confusing, exactly, because there's a
we
should, yeah, lay to just lay a couple pieces out.
A little more than 150, anyway, right?
So it just comes out of this projected surplus, very small surplus. 0.6%, it's going to come down lower.
Yes.
And the only reason, just to be clear, we didn't find any money in FY18. There was no money we found from FY18.
No, we actually cut the 150 out of FY18 and are hoping to fund it out of FY17 savings.
And the only reason we can offer up the FY17 savings is because we're within a few months of the end of 17. And we got lucky about who left the district. They were highly paid individuals who left.
I will say we're also very closely monitoring. 3 months sounds like a short time horizon, but I'm learning 3 months can be a very long time horizon. which is why we actually now are meeting every 2 weeks to go through transportation out of district consultation services to make sure that we don't suddenly have more than we anticipated.
I want to clarify, I don't mean lucky in terms of the individuals leaving. I realized I was hanging in the air over my head. That was not my intent. What I was talking about is the reason we were able to offer up so much in FY17, we'll call it regenerated cash, is because the dollar value in aggregate of the unpredictable events that occurred is such that it allows us to do that. This is why it's a one-time deal. So I just want to make two things very clear. Number one, it's a one-time deal because we're so close to the end of the year that we have certainty, and that certainty allows us to predict with much greater accuracy than we could have 18 months ago or even 12 months ago. When we're
it's not an aberration, though. We usually are.
Happens.
We usually have some additional, but we just don't know how much.
Right.
And the second thing is we didn't find more money in 18. That's not what that discussion was about. So I just want to clarify those 2 points.
And part of it, too, is we have been challenging all purchases going through to make sure that we are spending where we should, and if it's something that we shouldn't necessarily have to do right now, that we can look to defer it. We are, every item that's going through, whether it's technology or other areas, we are making sure we're scrutinizing it and implementing processes to make sure that the right people are looking at it from quotes and prices and what we're doing.
And to go much closer would bring us much, so if we're talking about offering on the order of 150 out of 260K, projected modest 0.6% surplus, I want to point out that in my mind, that's where these risk factors you've spelled out really start to kick in if you go much lower. So if someone asks, why not more, can you speak to how at that point you're getting within 0.3%, 0.2% projections, and you can't spend money you don't have
right.
to meet needs, right? So we have to meet legal requirements. We have to meet staffing levels. So
we did, not that I want to joke about it, because I do have, being licensed, it is near and dear to my heart to make sure that regular, from a legal standpoint, we cannot spend more.
This is as low as we can go without
taking. Then the budget, and part two where I caution is there are always those, you just don't know if somebody else is going to go out on. You could have custodians go out where we have to pay overtime and substitute custodians to come in and cover. We have graduation coming up, which in and of itself might have additional custodial or whatnot costs associated with it. I meet with Julian very frequently, and there are times where you may have servers that are failing where you absolutely have to go out and get upgrades and buy the technology, where we have to look to other areas and say, okay, I have to take it from this cost center because we absolutely have to make this purchase. So I would not be comfortable trying to say we're at a zero, because there's a lot of unknowns that can happen, and I don't think it would be fiscally responsible to say we got it down to the penny, because you could just have that unforeseen item that
in the last week
that
of June
comes up.
So I'm sorry, just last point, just that so that's why you wouldn't run this to zero. So we are taking finance committee talked about an extra 100K in free cash toward this 438, and someone may look at this 259 number and say, well, why don't you take that to zero and not take the free cash? And I think if you could just speak to the reasons you're giving are the reasons why we cannot do that.
Exactly, and which is also why we are saying we're going to continue to monitor that number over the next month and a half before we start to say, okay, let's start buying the technology that we would not be buying next year. We want to make sure that it's as solid of a number, and we don't do something that we then have to reassess.
So one of the just made me think of the risks, the list you've been, I think it's probably an evolving list. I think one of the things that'd be good to add to that, maybe just not just so you for your own use, and maybe we can discuss it at some point, is, you know, we should probably identify if that risk occurs, what's an appropriate funding source. Because, you know, you mentioned a server goes. Now that we may be apt to go to the FinCom for a reserve fund transfer. So, you know, some of those risks aren't going to be born in the operating budget. We can go elsewhere. So we should probably know that in advance.
Absolutely. And we had talked about that even in the special education realm, if suddenly something happened there. But we can add that. That's a good point.
Anything else from the committee? Thank you very much. Well, 8:45, we're done.
All right,
good job.
Okay.
We are behind schedule, and I know there's people who came out to see this, so thank you for putting up with it. But there's a lot on our docket tonight.
Yes.
Ms. Wilson,
so,
we're very excited.
I'm going
to
do a student services update. I want to thank my team chairs and
one of our board members from the CPAC who has come out to kind of hear the update. I do have a copy of my PowerPoint. I'll pass that around. I also have a copy just to refresh people's memory of the findings from the Walker report. It's just kind of a brief copy that I made, so that it's a little easier for people to capture. So following that discussion, just to give you a frame of what's happening in my office and why it's so hard sometimes to capture what are the big picture things that are happening in student services. The biggest one we always talk about is special education, the RISE preschool. I oversee all of our Section 504 work in the district, the behavioral health work that we're doing, nursing. I am the district's homeless liaison. I also oversee the English language learner supports that we provide. So I'm going to highlight mostly special education and what we're doing on that front, but know that there are things happening in all of those areas. So if I don't touch on them, it doesn't mean there aren't great things happening. It just means that I was trying to kind of bring us to a focus point of what I spend a lot of my time on and what my staff spend time on. So what I'm going to do in my presentation is I'm going to give you some of the data. I'm not going to read through the slides. You guys can take a look at them, and I can absolutely send it to you electronically so you can get a better copy than this. We're going to talk a little bit about the work we've been doing around compliance, capacity, and communication. I'm going to talk specifically about what work I've been doing with Joshua Eaton and the next steps around Joshua Eaton, and then really go into some final thoughts. I've built into the presentation some slides that are just questions. So if you can hold your time, I've tried to section it out to make it easier for people so that I can kind of get a flow and go through some of this. So why don't I start with looking at some of the trends. This is a chart you're very familiar with. It's just our overall enrollment. It's right out of the budget book. Talks about that, you know, we have on average, if you go back over the 12 years of this, about 67 students out of district. It fluctuates up and down, but around that amount. And that is, if you look at our students with disabilities, about 7% of our students go out of district. They need a more restrictive placement. That, you know, seems, you know, kind of in the ballpark. It seems to be our average. But I just wanted to give that as kind of the overall, what we saw and we talked about through the budget process is that our numbers of students on IEPs is going down. So when you're looking at our percentage, we are below the state average for the percentage of students on identified with disabilities. These are our program numbers. I think the biggest takeaway for me is for you all and for the community to know that the majority of our students identified with disabilities are serviced through our learning center that's at each of our schools. Our specialized programs really are specialized, and they're for certain populations that need that level of programming. So this just kind of shows you that overall, this is our in-district numbers. This isn't reflective of out-of-district placement. And then I wanted to give you some evaluation data. So it's always very interesting to think about evaluation. So as we've talked about in the past, that parents at any point can request that their child be evaluated for special education. And then also through our SST, our student support teams, our staff can identify that they suspect a child might have a disability. These evaluations can consist of evaluating in one area, for instance, like speech or OT, or they may consist of a psychological evaluation, an academic evaluation, a teacher of the visually impaired, a teacher of the deaf and hard of hearing. So there's a lot of facets to this that go into these evaluations. For some students, it can be a short period of time. For other students, it can take a long period of time. These evaluations, when we do special education evaluations, they happen during the school day. So during the hours that the students are with us is when they're evaluated. So it's just really important for you to understand that this is all happening during the school day, and our evaluators and specialists are very sensitive to the time that they pull students out of class, but it is time that students would be removed from something. So what you're looking at here is looking at our total number of evaluations for each school. The number of those evaluations that we've received thus far this year that were initiated by parents. So you can see some trends. I mean, this is really just kind of raw data. And then the number of parent referrals that resulted in eligibility, the number of school team referrals, and those that resulted in eligibility. We definitely saw an influx at Joshua Eaton in parent referrals, which, you know, may be tied into our level three status, but I think that's just important to note there, because at this point in the year, Joshua Eaton has had the same number of parent referrals as Reading Memorial High School, and the high school is a much bigger school. Birch Meadow also had an influx at the very start of the year of parent referrals. Most of their referrals were earlier in the year. As you can see, their parent referrals are done, whereas you see the other ones that are in process, those are coming right now. We have 30 school days to complete the evaluations, and we need to meet with the families and the team within this 45 school day period. So this is kind of what's happening, just to give you a sense of what's happening in our buildings right now and the work that our staff are doing with families. Our goal is that when you see those school team referrals, we want to see a really accurate finding. So we want, our goal is that as educators, we are finding the right students. We're meeting our child find obligation, which means when we identify a student through our SST process, we are saying this is a student we suspect is having a disability. Overall, our numbers are pretty good, but we do have some areas we still need to work on in that. So this is just a breakdown for you of the disability categories. So in other presentations, I've gone over what the disability categories are that as an educational team, we can find students eligible under. This gives you a breakdown of where our students fall in the district and kind of a percentage. If it was under 10, I didn't report the total number because I didn't want to disclose any personally identifiable information. But just again, I had hoped to find the state average, but nobody seemed to know exactly where it is. So if I find the state averages on this, I will put another document together just so you can compare. But again, I wanted you to see some of the data about where, what categories of disability are we servicing here in Reading, where do most of our students lie. Developmental delay, it's important to note that that category is for our younger children under 8 years old. So once those students reach around third grade, they either are, may not be found eligible, or they may, the diagnosis might flesh out into specific learning disability or some other category. But that's, most of that is our younger, I would say, Debbie would say that's our preschool, a lot of our preschool students are in that category. So this was just to give you, again, I just wanted you to have some data to really understand what the population of students is that we're servicing. This is our placement data. Again, I put up their approximate because, as Gail said, special education is a moving target. We have many team meetings in a day, and these numbers change. But this gives you a sense within our district and in our out-of-district. So the number of students in each of these placement categories and what that really means. So when a student, when we say a student is fully included, they're removed less than 21% of their day. And this is all calculated through we have a lovely computer system, and when we develop IEPs, it helps calculate that for us. So my team chairs don't sit with calculators and add this up. Thankfully, we used to. But now, so this is just to give you a sense and also help you sort of have an understanding what is meant by full inclusion, partial inclusion, substantially separate. Those are numbers at Rise Preschool, and then our out-of-district numbers, as we've talked about. So really sort of that breakdown that the majority of our students are serviced within a full inclusion model. You know, when you think about, when we've talked about the tier and that level of instruction, you see that, you know, we are kind of representing those tiers in special education. The majority of our students are getting a full inclusion program. Some students need the partial, you see, and some students need the more intensive. That's going to be at the top. So again, I wanted to give you a good picture here. So the focus is this year. I kind of took on the focuses of compliance, looking at our state and federal regulations, capacity, and communication. So I'm going to talk about each of these areas of things that we've been doing. They're not all exciting. Maybe to me they are, but they're not all kind of flashy things, but they're really important priorities in the work that we do around special education. and they're aligned with the district goals. So I think the other piece I want to emphasize is that without the support of the central office team, the principals, the team chairs, none of this work. This is not me doing all of this work. I'm leading, I'm supporting, but I need the support of my team, the principals, the team chairs to do this work. So compliance. This is really, I was talking to the CPAC before I came here, is it seems like a pretty minimal thing. Like we should be able to just be in compliance with state and federal regulations. This is a big task for a district our size to make sure that we have consistency in our process. And this is so important because when we stop being, or when we make errors, I will say it's errors, when we make errors, it breaks down the trust we have with families. Because if, from a parent perspective, we should know what we are supposed to do from a regulatory perspective. And we should do those things. We shouldn't be getting into dialogue on whether it's 3 days, 5 days, that we didn't do something we were supposed to do. So this is why compliance is so important. It's a baseline for us to establish that trusting relationship with families to ensure that we are meeting those state and federal guidelines. But to me, it starts with that relationship with the parent. That if we can be in compliance and follow this process, parents begin to trust us. And we can actually talk about the real issues, the way we're going to support their child, the way we're going to meet their child's needs. If we are spending a lot of our energy on compliance issues, that's going to take our team away from the real work we need to do with families and students. So we're continuously reviewing our processes in special education. And I have Kelly Boswick sitting here, so I'm going to acknowledge her, and she wouldn't want to take this credit, but she's really stepped up this year as one of the lead team chairs and has helped align our processes both across the elementary and vertically. She has been running what we call Team Chair Boot Camp and working with all of our team chairs to ensure consistency in our process. She created an amazing binder with all the forms that we use. She gave them to all the team chairs, along with a little memory stick with all the forms on it electronically to really help align our processes. I know other people don't get excited about this, but I do because it's important and we need to do this and we need to do it consistently. Our families need to be able to go from one school to another and have a similar experience. Each team chair has their own personality, their own way that they run meetings, but in terms of the forms and the processes and how we implement things, it should be consistent as a district. So I'm appreciative to the team chairs and for Kelly and her leadership in working on this. This year we made a huge switch, and I haven't talked about this a lot, but we switched our IEP software, which is a huge undertaking for staff, huge. We switched from SEMS Tracker, which Reading had been using for years and years, and I came along and said, no, we're going to eSped. It has been a huge amount of work to make this conversion, but we're so excited because in this new software, we are getting much more accurate data. The team chairs are working to ensure that the data that's coming out of there is accurate, it's reflective of our numbers, and it's going to allow us to run reports, capture service delivery, and know what's happening in our buildings. There's still a lot of work to be done on it to make it 100% accurate, but it's a software system. I have to say, from my end as an administrator, I find being able to access what I need a lot easier than I did in SEMS Tracker. So that's been a huge undertaking that we've been doing that started the end of last year, and the staff have really, with a lot of support and coaching from their team chairs, they have done the work that needs to get done to do this conversion. And that's never an easy task. Team chairs consistently review all IEPs before they're being sent to families. So again, we're having administrators look at documents. We're ensuring that things are going out the way they should. We're working collaboratively, as we talked about, to have consistency. We have improved our filing process. Again, these are not exciting things, but these are great steps that we're taking to be in compliance. When families are requesting their records, we are feeling much more confident that what we're providing parents is the actual documentation that is the student record. We are being more diligent to making sure the right documents are being sent to central office, they're being filed appropriately. When I came in, there were a lot of errors. Things were filed in the wrong student files. We have done so much work the RISE secretary, Denise, I'm sure she's not watching, but she has done so much to improve the process and take initiative and streamline that to make it usable, to make sure things are accessible. When I need something in a file, it's there, and that's great. We have our mid-cycle review with the Department of Education scheduled for April 26th. They have rescheduled it twice. I have not requested that, so just know they have contacted me in December as well as in March to say they needed to reschedule. So we're hoping they're coming April 26th to kind of do a checkpoint. This is a mid-cycle, so it's mid our six-year cycle. Really, it's a one day. They kind of are coming in to see how we're doing on the areas we were previously cited. And once they come out, I'll report out to you how that goes. So compliance, I'm going to kind of put all these up here. What I did was take a look at those findings that I gave you. Oops, I went too far on that one. And kind of and match that up with areas that I thought were compliance related from the Walker findings. So things that we have done that had been pointed out in those findings. One thing to highlight is we did come up with a criteria and process for determining through the IEP team process when a student needs the support of a paraprofessional. We're still tweaking the process, but we have a process and some guidelines for teams to use. But this, these are some of the compliance areas, and here are some of the other compliance concerns. And some of these you know about, which is that we don't use eMARC anymore for services for our 18 to 22 year olds or for our high school programming. That was a big concern that they had highlighted. We have been looking at program descriptions, and I'm going to talk about that a little later. And we also use a program called Program Exploration as a way with families to determine whether or not a student needs to be placed in our specialized programs. We also are using the DCAP, and that is available in all the buildings. Things that we still need to work on. We still need to work on, in our MTSS structure, how we're referring students for special education. What is that process? We've talked about this as a leadership team. What are the structures? What are the things that each building can do a little different? And what are the things that need to be consistent across the district? So we're working on calibrating that process. We continue to need to look at schedules to make sure that students are getting the services they need, along with access to that general education content. Part of our action planning around closing the achievement gap is a review to ensure that students, when they're pulled out, are not getting pulled out of that core content instruction. It is a big push that we have, and we're working with the principals on it, but it's still something we need to work on. We have to look at one of the findings was around entrance and exit criteria. And I know there's been I've had lots of conversations with the CPAC. My biggest concern is that IEP teams make that decision. So I would rather frame it as these are guidelines for teams to consider. I can't, sitting in my shoes, say who should go into a program and not go into a program. Those decisions are made by IEP teams. I think the best we can do is give some guiding criteria that teams can consider in making that determination. I struggle with entrance and exit because it means that there are these bright line rules, and students are not bright line rules. They're individual students that teams should be considering as individuals. And some students may require a certain program even though they don't meet the entrance criteria. So I'm looking at it more as we're going to come up with some guidelines that teams can use to consider when making these decisions. We talked about as well that we need to continue to look at the structure of the Students Services Office. A big piece of what we talked about all fall was the need for an assistant director. As you saw from all the work that's happening, there's only so much you can do in a day, and we do our best, but that's a continued area of need and something we need to continue discussing. So, around compliance.
Thank you for that part of the presentation, Mr. Robinson.
I just had a question that I just didn't know whether I understood it. On slide number 3,
yeah.
The evaluation data.
Yeah.
So I just want to make sure I understood the columns correct.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Did you
I'll get back there. Yep.
So I just used Barrows as an example because it's at the top.
Yep.
So with the 20 evaluations, so 13 came from parents and 7 came from the school. I'm not disputing that. I just find I would have thought it would have been the other way around, that our teachers would be picking that. No.
No, and what you see when you look at the, so if you look at the number of parent, the other piece there is if you see there's 13 parent referrals.
Right.
Of those, only one has been found eligible. There are 3 in process. So we do get a lot of parent referrals. I think there's a lot of questions about your child's learning. Mm-hmm. Sometimes families feel that if their child is struggling, it must be a disability.
So that makes sense. That's the column I didn't understand.
Yes. Right. So what you're seeing is we're trying to do our child find obligation and say these are the kids we suspect have a disability, which should be a smaller number. So our teams are really looking at, these are kids we suspect. The parents could be any parent, and there's really not too much we can, you know, once a parent requests, we move forward with the evaluation. Mm-hmm. So
I have a question on this slide. What's the time frame that this data covers?
This is from the start of this school year until March 24th, is that, am I right? Was it March or March 17th? It's like
school year to date.
Yeah.
Pretty close.
Yeah, pretty close year to date.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, this is all for students being evaluated to go on to IEPs or other support programs.
Yeah.
Right.
Do we have an evaluation system for the reverse? Do students ever come off of IEPs? And what's
their numbers?
Yes, so
that's through the reevaluation process. I don't have that data, but that's a great, I'd like to show you some of that data too.
And how common is that when we look at these trends in the previous slide where you have the enrollment per program across the schools? So two questions about those. What is our mechanism for making sure that as we get the evaluation and the reevaluation data that we have the right capacity in terms of our budget planning for the students that are coming into or leaving or graduating from these supports?
So it's very unpredictable because nothing is predetermined. So that's the hardest piece when you're looking at a reevaluation. Sometimes we know that a student is going to come off an IEP, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we don't need to have that service or that service provider. I don't have a mechanism for saying, yes, you know, the team chairs keep me in the loop more around things that have a more significant cost, I would say. If we're anticipating something might be going out of district, if we're anticipating that we need a specialized consult, we've had a new student move in who has some significant needs. But in regards to kids coming on and off, that happens so frequently, it would be hard to, you know, I try to run reports to capture what are our current numbers.
Just to follow up on that, it's a bit of a broader question. I appreciate the unpredictability of all of this. I just want to understand the kind of the information flow within your system. So at a high level, you were able to break this down into like type of disability and certain types that I imagine require different services for those different types of disabilities. So is there a mechanism to go from that assessment? So you've obviously done some assessment to group and aggregate to look at the capacities you're building at these different schools and these different programs. Mm-hmm. And then when we do our strategic budget planning and goal setting planning, do you check in once a year to kind of connect those two and say, oh, well, it looks like we're going to need another, you know, person with this type of skill next year or in 2 years because
sort
we're
of,
seeing an increase
yeah,
in this?
It's kind of both. It's ongoing because we may have new needs that arise in a particular building where we need some training or we need some consultation because we don't have that. So that may come up through an individualized IEP. I'm looking at staffing kind of on a regular basis. We go over caseloads, we look at individual schedules, we make sure all service deliveries can be met within a particular building. So Joshua Eaton's a good example. After reviewing all of that, we realized we were short staffed and we needed to add that. One of the things I'll be doing this spring is, again, working with the team chairs and the building principals, taking a capture. So with our new software, we can do what's called the service delivery report. So you can run a report of all the service delivery, kind of take a look at how many hours, start looking at, you know, because it's not, you don't run a report and say, this is how many hours, so this is how many FTEs, because they're people. and they're little people who, some of them work well together, some don't. So there's, the report is one piece of data, but the actual knowledge my teachers have about the students and their grouping and their professional judgment of how to best service those students is another factor. So all of that goes into play in doing that work. So I try to do it ongoing as I meet with the team chairs. Who are new kids? How many new kids are we seeing? What is that, you know, what kind of strain is that putting on? Or on the other hand, are we finding some kids not eligible? I track enrollment. I'm looking at each program, the chart I showed you that has the programs and the learning center by grade. I'm looking at where those are going. What are the needs for next year? Is there a bubble? You know, so do we have a grade, like a fourth grade that's really big that we're going to need to start looking at Coolidge and Parker? What is that going to do when they get to sixth grade? So we're looking at all of those factors as we kind of progress along. But sometimes it's unpredictable because of those 20, you know, those 13 parent evaluations, you could have found five eligible. I don't have a way to predict for you of those evaluations, how many would be.
Mm-hmm. So. Just a quick question. When was the Walker report?
It was in
2 years ago?
2014-15 school year, my first year.
Okay. And I was just wondering if you could briefly introduce your staff that's here so that we know.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Adam Blaustein is one of our high school team chairs. Kelly Boswick is a team chair for Wood End and Birch Meadow. Debbie Butts is the Rise Preschool. And Amy Benjamin is at Joshua Eaton.
Okay. Thank you for staying and sticking with us. Sorry.
Any other compliance?
Oh, Mr. Bobbin.
Yeah. One more. Have you had any discussions or do you see any connection between the proposal, the earlier presentation we had about collapsing the CP and SCP tracks for some subjects on the population that you manage, and you know, what thinking has been done around what this population would need to succeed in that environment?
I think Mr. Barker touched on it when he presented about differentiated instruction, where we're working closely with our middle school team chairs on the transition up and with Mr. Blaustein and looking at those sections. So we do have co-taught sections and we have supported sections, and that's going to continue. But really looking at what we're doing around universal design, differentiated instruction, and the capacity of our staff. All right, so we got through compliance. So now I'm going to talk about capacity. So a big focus for me, and if you look at our district goals, we talk about closing the achievement gap. And so when I think about what my charge is for that around special education, it really is about looking at the capacity of our staff. And how do we develop our staff, both our general education staff and our special education staff, to meet the needs of diverse learners? That population of students they're receiving is becoming more and more complex in the general education setting. And how do we ensure that they're equipped with the tools they need to meet those students where they're at? So the focus this year was looking at how we're supporting all of our staff. This year, for the first time, I worked closely with Human Resources, and we developed a process for ensuring all staff were receiving training and information on mandated topics in electronic format. So previously I had gone to every school and done a roadshow on the first 2 days of school, which was lovely to have the FaceTime with staff, but also very time consuming. So this year we developed a mechanism where staff had the opportunity to review different policies, and then we could check in on them if needed. So this was a big undertaking to kind of pull that all together to make sure they had the documents they needed. The other piece this year, the Bridge program has continued the connection with the Landmark School. We have a consultant from Landmark School who has spent some time at Parker, although he's had less time at Parker, and he's begun this year to work at the high school. He's been to the high school 2 days, I believe, and he has been shadowing the students in the Bridge program. He goes in and observes the instruction that's happening, and then he meets with the staff after to provide some coaching and some feedback on some strategies they could implement. I think I've spoken about Alan Bloom. He's a retired professor from Simmons. He's very well respected in the area of special education. He has continued his work with Reading. We provided any staff who hadn't seen him with an overview on writing IEPs, writing measurable IEPs, and compliant IEPs. And then how we used him this year was he had dedicated time in each of our buildings, and he worked with our special education teams, our related service staff, like speech, OT, PT, school psychologists, and really answered people's questions in a much smaller setting, provided them opportunity to bring sample goals, to bring sample IEPs, and to get feedback in the moment. It's really helped with that consistency of our process. We are also, and Alan is also coming in May to work with the general education staff at Joshua Eaton. Amy and Eric are putting together the grade level groups, and he's going to be working with them throughout the day, smaller groups for about an hour, just helping them understand the difference between accommodations and modifications. I know it sounds, again, very basic, but these are really important concepts to help our staff understand their role in supporting students with disabilities and understanding those pieces of the IEP. And then we're continuing our district-wide PLC work, so our teachers who work in our district-wide programs, they have district-wide PLC time where they're looking at student data, they're looking at their programs. One of our groups, the Crossroads group, actually used their time. They took the opportunity in their PLC to look at outside evaluations. So many of our students get evaluated by outside providers, and they brought redacted copies, and they looked at those recommendations to see if they're in line with what they're doing, and to see if there are things that they can improve either in their practice or the way they're articulating their program, which I thought was wonderful work that they're doing. So we also this year, I think I spoke about, we used some grant funding to start a district-wide data team. So I've pulled together staff and used some grant funding to stipend them. And we're working with a retired assistant superintendent of pupil personnel from Tri-Town, it's Sharon Stewart, to facilitate. It's nice to have a facilitator because then I get to be part of the conversation and not the facilitator. And we're talking about, in the world of special education, how do we do data-driven conversations? So that's been really nice, and we want to continue this going into next year. We have 7 trainers in the district for our QBS, our safety care, which is our restraint and de-escalation. This allows us to train staff on a regular basis in either the full restraint process or de-escalation. Many of our staff are seeking the de-escalation, and so this group of trainers is available to do that. I also think it's worthy to note, and that's why I put it on here, we have 3 special ed staff who wanted to, are not team chairs, who wanted to attend a leadership forum for new or aspiring team chairs. So we're starting to cultivate some of our own leaders in-house, which, as you know from the Walker Report, and historically, we have had a lot of turnover in the team chair position. So it's very exciting to see that there are people interested in developing this skill, and we are supporting that. I'm not going to go through all these, but what I did for you on these slides was go through what type of professional development or coaching we provided in looking by level, so you can see all the work we are doing. And I want to highlight the high school because I know the biggest concern of this committee was around our reading and the teaching of reading. And I hope that what you can see up here is a lot of targeted training for our special education staff at the high school around teaching reading. Although we haven't found a teacher who is credentialed, we've been filling that in through contracted service. We have been trying to grow our own people and get them trained. So we've been doing a lot on this. And you'll see I did each level for you to give you a sense of what's been happening. Some of the things that we have addressed around capacity that we are doing, we're providing regular clinical supervision for our counseling staff and our TSP staff, which was a concern in the Walker Report. We've developed the basic program descriptions, and we have them posted on my website. And we're sharing those out with staff and families. There were concerns in the Walker Report around our capacity to meet the behavioral needs of students in the district. At that time, we didn't have a BCBA. We now have a full-time BCBA, and we are anticipating a 0.5 BCBA in next school year's budget. Things that we need to continue to work on is our MTSS framework, and that's a district-wide piece and sort of how we use data to guide our instruction and our supports for students. So how are we continuing to do that? We also need to work, and Mr. Martin and I have talked about this a lot, on how we coordinate our professional development efforts together so that we're supporting our general education, our special education, and our paraprofessional staff. And we need to be more focused on inclusive practices and co-teaching.
That's awesome. So do you feel like you're actually going to be able to hire the 0.5 BCBA? I think I remembered that. Mm-hmm. We had tried to get that as a 1.0 in the budget, right, for next year. So is that going to be a doable thing to do?
We're hopeful. Keep asking our current BCBA if she has friends. I also know, interestingly, one of our close community, they're looking for like a 0.3. So sort of been thinking about that as well.
That's what I was
wondering. Like, if they need a 0.3 and
Wakefield,
we need a 0.5, maybe we could attract, you know. So, but it's definitely something we still need.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I just wanted to say that being a part of the CPAC and hearing the conversations, the parents that come have so much knowledge. It's humbling what they've learned through their years, and the conversations, the questions that they ask are very difficult ones, and the answers have been very transparent. It's hard often to accept how much time it takes to get answers, but what you've been telling them and us has just undertaking these changes for the Walker Report and seeing the reactions of the CPAC parents as well. A case in point is the extended school year programs mm-hmm. that are coming, and I've now been to three of these presentations and to see how the questions have been addressed, to see how the staffing has taken into account the concerns of the parents and changed the program, and to see the investment of the staff and the growing satisfaction of the parents is really something. I'm so glad I can be a fly on the wall to these meetings. And as you've said, as you've highlighted, there are still things that need to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, it can't all happen at once.
Mm-hmm.
But I have felt very fortunate to be able to watch this process and very grateful to the leaders in the CPAC who are putting their time into coordinating this and working closely with you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are we using the data coach in our capacity building?
We are not using her currently. She's got a pretty full plate, but my idea is that eventually I would take her into doing some of this work with us. But she's doing a lot of work with our building principals, and so for right now, I'm trying to do mine internally, and then once we have a structure, then I can pull upon her.
I just want to make a comment. Something that jumped out to me is the ability to develop capacity and staff, and the fact that there are teachers who are now saying that they want to be team chairs.
Mm-hmm.
That's tremendously exciting.
Mm-hmm. It's
really,
exciting.
Really exciting to have somebody in that position who's taught
mm-hmm.
in the district, who knows the program well, and then when you bring in new staff to replace
mm-hmm.
that, ultimately, they're a mentor, a built-in mm-hmm. mentor. That's just tremendously exciting.
And one of our team chairs, Kelly Decato, who is not here tonight, but team chair for Birch Meadow and Killam, she was a special ed teacher and kind of took the plunge and has been amazing, and we're so happy to have her as a team chair. So
before you move on, Mr. Robinson had one.
I actually, along those lines, is that leadership form, is that something we're doing in the district, or is that someplace we're sending
them?
So
we're sending them to North Shore Consortium, and actually Sharon Stewart, who's retired, is running that forum. And Kelly Bostwick is also supporting some of them internally as well, who are looking to get their license.
I just was curious, do we have any recruiting or retention goals for the capacity building efforts?
I haven't made any yet.
Continuous improvement.
Yeah. So communication, which is another big area of focus. So I didn't have too much here, but wanted to let people know that, you know, my website is up and functioning, which is very exciting. It was a big push, I think, from the CPAC, and I had worked hard to kind of pull that together. So it is up. I've worked closely with the parents to identify things they feel would be important on the website to include those components. So we have that up. I'm going to be sending out little blurbs to the principals to ask them to put it in their newsletters, because parents read the principals' newsletters. They don't need a communication from me. And so that would encourage them to go to my website and check out the information. I also do communication updates with staff. I try to do a monthly update to them, kind of a newsletter that highlights important topics. I usually write something to them. I send them links to free resources or training. I provide them with, you know, timely reminders. When we had the Blue Ribbon, I highlighted different presenters for them and encouraged them to attend certain sessions. I also try my best to participate in some of our district-wide PLC meetings, to have that face time with staff, and to do that level of communication at the staff side. And then in terms of the CPAC, it really has been, I think, a great year. They have their new website up with lots and lots of helpful information. I feel that the board has been very active in communicating with me. They schedule time to meet with me at least monthly, sometimes more than that. And they provide great feedback from families or things they're hearing. The CPAC has had much more regular meetings this year that are really built around both having business meetings and also educational seminars for parents. We've had presentations on anxiety, dyslexia, and ADHD, the extended school year. And after April vacation on April 27th, we're going to have a presentation by two of our school psychologists in the district. We're going to be presenting about what work they do, what type of testing they do, what does it all mean. I've also hosted with the CPAC two coffee and conversations, one at Birch Meadow and one at Joshua Eaton. These are really kind of informal opportunities for families to come in and talk to myself. I've had the principal and the team chair there. And a representative from the CPAC. We're trying to encourage people to join the CPAC and also to come and talk to us about what's going well. I mean, we had a wonderful coffee and conversation at Birch Meadow. It was just a really lovely morning with a handful of parents. And at Joshua Eaton, we did not have as many families, unfortunately, but we did have some members of the school council, and we had some really good conversations with the CPAC and the school council about ways to collaborate more and to encourage some more parents of students with disabilities to get involved in some of these opportunities. So overall, I think we've had a great year, and we're trying to get more people to join the CPAC board and really lighten the load for those families that are taking the lead. We've seen some new families this year, and we want them to keep coming back. It's a really positive group. They're very collaborative. They're very supportive of the work we do. So it really helps me as a director to hear from them. And they do provide very honest feedback. I don't think they hold back. But it's much appreciated because I want to hear their perspective and I want to know what's going right. They also do a really nice job encouraging families who might be having struggles to reach out to myself. So they don't need to, as a CPAC board member, bear that burden that they say, this, you know, you need to contact Carolyn about this. So that's what we're doing on the communication front.
What helps you do this?
What helps me do this? Yeah. More time in the day?
are there things that others on your in the community, other parents, what can we do to support this in your mind? What has worked? I like the communication efforts. It's really good. Anything that you can share in terms of best practices, anything that you think is going in a good direction?
Well, the website is new for me. So thanks to Dr. Doherty, he's kind of given me some tips. And my administrative assistant is amazing, and I think with her support, like, we're getting better. I think we just, I think it's important for people to know, and I think the frustration, and you know, you heard it as well, that families had is I didn't have it up right away. We don't have other people. That's me. I am the person. So I just think that's really important for people to understand, and that sometimes, you know, student issues pull me away from time to design a website. And as much as I know it's a priority, you have to manage your time. So, you know, it's hard when you do all the jobs. You can't think of, like, what I could really use because you just do it. There are things you have to get done, and you do that. But I think it's, for me, it's if people have ideas, say, you know, oh, this would be great on your website. Because I would love to. I had a parent who said, oh, check out, you know, this community's website. We like these resources. That's really helpful because it's great to, I don't want to say steal, but like you don't need to, like, leverage. You can borrow things, right? And I can make it my own. I don't need to, you know, when you have a blank web page, it's a little overwhelming, I have to say. And then once you start filling in the content, it helps. But I welcome people to give me feedback and say, hey, I saw this on so-and-so's website. And I think a lot of what the CPAC does, which I think is great, is say, oh, I saw this other district is doing this. Can we do something like that? Yes, we can. Let's make it in a reasonable time frame. I think sometimes what people want is like they want it tomorrow. And you need to understand the work I'm doing around changing things does take time. And if we want to have a successful CPAC, we have to take on what we can handle and not overburden our parents either. So I'm trying to help them not take off, and Linda, you've been part of some of those conversations, like not take on too much. Like we want to sustain those members we have. So.
Anything else?
One more slide. So just a little about Joshua Eaton. And I'm not gonna talk about this too much, but I spend a lot of time at Joshua Eaton. I am gonna do a report out to you more on the Bridge program because I know there's some concerns about that, but that could be a whole meeting in and of itself. We're really looking at the Bridge program structure. I've been doing a lot of work with Amy. We've been observing the classrooms. We've been looking at student schedules. We're working with staff to evaluate student needs. We wanna look at the schedule. We're looking at placement of students with disabilities. And then we're continuing looking at the idea of the least restrictive environment. And so this is my final thought because it's the most important thing that we do. And I wanna leave you with this thought about inclusion, because we need to, as a community, focus on inclusion. Inclusion, I love this quote because it's not a setting or a placement. It's about the fact that all of the students in our buildings are our students. They're not special education students. All of our students are our students, and we need to be an inclusive school setting, and we need to do the work together to make sure that our staff understand that, our families feel that way, and our students feel that way when they come into our buildings.
It's a great quote. Great.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Anything from the committee?
It's really
a thorough presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Anything from the public who wanted to add anything? Thank you, Ms. Wilson.
Thank you.
Really excellent.
Excellent job.
Can I give one observation?
You can. I was thinking about sharing an observation. You go first.
You can go if you I mean, I have not had to talk much tonight, which is a good thing because it means other people are doing presenting. But I think you heard tonight from each member of this team some form of in-depth presentation, project, pieces that they are working on as part of their job. And I think it just shows the quality and caliber of each of these three individuals and the work that they do each and every day. I want the committee to understand that. I think you saw it tonight. Each of them talked about something that is part of their daily job. Each of them talked about the types of things that are happening in the areas that they focus on. But I think the important thing is we all work together as a team. We meet regularly, team. We have these discussions together. It is that strength that keeps this district moving. And to quote Carolyn, we don't have a lot of other people. We are the people that are doing this work, whether it be the website or putting together a blue ribbon presentation or making sure that the budget is balanced and, you know, making sure that we have the accurate information and data. That we're all working together to make sure that happens for this district. So I just want to say thank you to Gail, Craig, and Carolyn for all the work that they do.
And all the people behind you who are also shouldering multiple jobs. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Doherty. So I'm going to end with an observation. I've shared this with Carolyn, Ms. Wilson, I'm sorry, privately. But it's really tied to this final thought. And since we are discussing special education tonight, I'll share it publicly. In the last month, first of all, I want to start by saying there are some significant concerns in the district about special education, and I don't want to dismiss them or in any way be less than transparent about them. But I've had two conversations in the last month with two different parents at different schools with children at very different ages, and it was around their students' experience of inclusion. And they were very emotional conversations and very, very special and beautiful conversations. And I think it's important to look at the data, and that you know how I am. I like the charts and the data, and I want to see all the trends. But it's powerful to talk to a parent whose child, who they love more than anything in the world, is benefiting in a deeply powerful way because of the direction, and both parents specifically mentioned inclusion, how fully included their children were, and in the things, I want to be careful about student privacy, the things we were discussing. So at least, anecdotally, I feel like this is being felt in some areas in the parent community and is so deeply appreciated in a way that transcends test scores or any of that in a very powerful way. So, so good work. Mrs. Sampi.
I'm so sorry because you did ask if there was any public comment and I didn't.
Yes, of course.
But, I just kind of an observation.
So you should come up to the.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Mr. Robinson.
No, that's okay. That's okay. I'm just joking. Michelle Sanfi. I just wanted to say, just reflecting and listening to Mrs. Wilson and Mrs. Borowski and Dr. Daugherty, and I'm just not going to say everybody's name, all of you. As a parent of a child with special needs who's been in the Reading Public School System now for, I think, 6 years? Let's say six. I think that it's very difficult sometimes to be patient. I know that my daughter has caused me to reach down deep for patience sometimes, and it's humbling, and it's a terrific growth experience. I think the processes of the way that special education is set up on the state level and the national level sometimes do just pit a parent against a school system, which is really unfortunate. I don't think that's the intent of the laws or the regulations, but I do think that that's what happens sometimes. So I would just say to any parent that's having a really difficult time that, you know, you will get through it. There are those fantastic moments, and there are those moments where you're just like ready to rip your hair out of your head, and that's the God's honest truth. But I have had a really wonderful experience in the 6 years, and that doesn't mean that we haven't had challenges. We certainly have, but through some really good communication and a lot of patience on the team side, I'm not talking about my husband and I think that we've really made a lot of great strides. So thank you.
Thank you, Mrs.
Thank you.
Sampi. That was a nice note to end on. Anything else? Yeah.
Motion to adjourn.
Before you do that, sorry, there is one more agenda item, and it's correspondence. Dr. Daugherty mentioned that all,
I have one item before you actually adjourn.
So all of the correspondence we've received since our last meeting has been copied in the packet. It'll be posted on the website. It'll be fully public as per our new protocol. Dr. Daugherty and I did run into a slightly challenging situation wherein a parent emailed the school committee with an email that had enough information in it that would make their child identifiable. Mm-hmm. And both Daugherty and I obviously don't feel it's appropriate to put that in the packet. So what I wanted to, but we want full transparency and for the committee to know. So the parent had significant concerns about the Bridge program at Eaton. And I encouraged that parent to both work through the CPAC on the policy side and to meet with Ms. Wilson, Dr. Daugherty, and myself broader level to discuss concerns. So those were the two approaches I suggested to her. But that email is not included in the packet because there just was no way to redact it without violating student privacy. So that's it for me. You had something, Mrs. Webb?
I just wanted to say thank you to this team that does everything because for the budget, the FY18 budget, I believe we had 90 or more questions that Mrs. Dowd provided answers to when we did the our review of the budget and Q&A. Then there were an additional 39 questions from the FinCom that were answered. And since I just went through all of these, and I don't know if this is all of the correspondence since about the mid to late February, there are 22 pages of questions and answers here, double-sided. So I wanna thank you for that. But I also, as we heard tonight and heard Ms. Wilson talk about communication and Dr. Daugherty talked about the pathways in the journal, and we talk about bringing people together in conferences, I just want to say that I think that you have extended many offers to people who have questions to come in and meet with yourself, the vice chair, Dr. Daugherty, any member of the staff. I know that Dr. Daugherty has plenty of coffees and meetings, and we have office hours. And I think that sometimes we can more effectively answer questions or at least get a richer dialogue going if people will come face-to-face. And I know that that has been extended to those people that have asked questions. And unfortunately, I don't think that it's been, it's happened. I don't know that they've taken us up on that. And I just would like to encourage the community, because this is a tremendous amount of resource to go back and forth on email volleys of questions. So thank you very, very much.
Mr. Bob?
And Ms. Baraska, I just want to thank you as our chairperson for bringing out this, working with the superintendent to come up with this method of disclosing the emails that we receive. That I think if one person's asking about it, a lot of people want to know about it. And I think this is a very efficient way to convey very detailed information without having to go through it line by line, although we're certainly happy to do that. One resource that maybe gets underutilized, to Elaine's point, is that school committee members, after most meetings, not all, but it's on the calendar. I'm kind of looking over my shoulder at the calendar here, but there's a column on the school committee calendar chart that indicates when office hours occur. So please do show up. We're here, two of us, half hour before the meetings to answer questions. You know, if you read one of these emails or have a different question, we want to make ourselves available. Of course, the superintendent has office hours as well, so that, to Elaine's point, there's a lot of additional resource that's being provided to the public to try to engage anybody who has a question, and I think it's the public's right to ask those questions, and I'm glad that we're finding new ways to answer and get that information out. Thank you, Jane.
Anything else? All right, quick update on the calendar. Town meeting's April 24th, and the school committee meets again the next night, April 25th. That'll be a busy week.
Please vote tomorrow.
And, yes, vote. There is town
You're not
elections
supposed
tomorrow.
To say that.
You can't say vote.
Well, anyway.
We have
you
an,
say
we
there's
have
an election tomorrow?
No. There's an election tomorrow.
There's an election tomorrow.
Thank you.
Do I have your motion?
Move to enter into executive session to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining and approval of minutes not to return to open session.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mrs.
Webb? Yes.
Dr. Doxer?
Yes.
Mr. Robinson?
Yes.
Mr. Baldwin?
Yes.
Mr. Nyan?
Yes.
Jim Breskies, yes. Good night.